already knows what the schedule is. Between 9 and 9:30 will be an overview. At 9:30, Parks and Rec will present their budget. At 10 o'clock will be the administration budget. At 11 will be Public Works. Starting at 12 to 1 will be lunch. And there we'll see if we have to make up time or not. That's scheduled for 1 hour. At 1 o'clock, we'll be doing the sewer budget. At 1:30, the fire department budget. 2:30, the police budget. And at 3:30, the library budget. So depending upon how things go, hopefully it'll go smoothly. Your presentations, and I'll go over this just in a few, there'll be presentations, there'll be time for questions and answers after each presentation, okay? First off, is I'm going to start off with just kind of a general overview. This is just some statistics that I was able to locate in terms of, you know, our population. We're a little over 18,000. We're over 18,000 now in 2010. Believe it or not, the females outnumber the males in Goffstown, whatever that's worth to you. The estimated median income in 2008 was $72,000, and in the year 2000, it was $55,000. I don't think you can. Oh, you can.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah, beautiful. Thank you.
The other point I wanted to make was, as you can see, in New Hampshire, the median income is $63,731. Also, just we were able to get some unemployment rates. In the United States, it's 9.7%. In New Hampshire, it's 5.5%. And in Goffstown, it's currently 5.1%. Now, what I did was, and I know this was a little bit, I apologize for this, so I'm going to kind of show you where the points are. And Steve, which one is it? It's this right here?
Yep.
Okay. It. I apologize for not being able to, I was trying to get this to be a white slide, but I couldn't do that. But the green line, the blue line here represents our budget. And as you can see, it kind of spiked in the year 2008, 2009. A couple of reasons for that, because we had we put the road program, which was historically a separate article, we put that in the budget. And then we also have some ARRA monies in 2009. The red line is our revenue. And the green line is the amount to be raised by taxation. As you can see, it is a slow and incremental increase. The next is our tax rate, and this is total tax rate. This is not just the town. This is town, school, state school, and the county. And as you can see, the top one obviously is the total, and from 2006 to 2007, relatively flat. We got some increased revenues on the school side, if you remember, and then it went up in 2010. And the one that we're here is the town, and it has been this trend line right here. And as you can see, that the school portion, this has kind of been, you know, with the different federal monies that are coming in, they've gotten a lot more revenues, but that'll be the school's issue to explain that. Now, what I did was I asked Scott Bartlett to take a look at three properties in Goffstown from 1992 to the present, and to look at assessed values, and to look at what did that person actually pay on their tax bill. So we tried to come up with the spectrum. I'm going to just jump down quickly to the bottom here. So we have one home that is currently assessed at $204,000. Another at 232, and another at 297. And as you can see, back in 1992, these three homes, according to Scott, there's been no major renovations to them. They have been kept up, et cetera, and he picked three random houses. If you want me to give you the address, I can. I don't know who they are. And so in 1992, this house that is now valued at $204,600 was valued at $120,900, and they paid $2,859 in tax. In the year 2010, which is the current tax bill right now, which is being mailed out, their taxes are going to be $4,687, which represents a 64% increase over a 19-year period of time. We then took a look at this house that was, this is about the average house in Goffstown, $232,000. Back in 1992, it was assessed at $131,000. They paid $3,100 in taxes, roughly. Now their tax bill is $5,315, or a 71% increase. And this one I kind of found kind of strange in a way. But this is the house that is valued the highest. And this is a house that is currently assessed at almost $300,000. Back in 1992, it was assessed at roughly $192,000. Back then, they paid $4,550 for taxes. Now their tax bill is $6,815 for an increase of 50%. So again, it seemed kind of strange to me that the higher end home, their tax bill would have gone up, I guess, the least of these three different properties, but it is what it is. Now, most, and more particularly, if you take a look at from the year 2005, so 1, 2, 3, 4, the last, say, 6 years, you can kind of get a feel for this particular house. Their tax bill went from $4,334 to $4,687, about $350. And then here, it went up about $500, $475, and here about, say, $700. Okay, over that six-year period of time. So, you know, there's been some speculation that, tax bills are going to double on our current trending, and that kind of that really does not play true here. So over a 19-year period of time, that would be almost two decades, they have not even doubled in any of those scenarios. And the reason why is because although the budgets may be doubling, the revenues are, there's corresponding revenues as well. Okay, now I'm just going to give you... Yeah.
Excuse me. Was that for a whole year, or is that for?
That's a whole year. Whole year.
Wow. I have to tell you, that's not the way my tax bill was. Yeah. Sorry, how
do
you say that?
All right. I happen to have mine, and I can show you mine mirrors that same thing. Now here's what we're going to be kind of doing today. Just want to give you a background of what we've done in the last couple of months. The department heads were asked to present three different budget scenarios to the Board of Selectmen. They had one budget scenario that was based upon their 2011 needs. They also had another budget scenario which was set to mirror the 2010 allocations. And then they had another scenario which was a 10% reduction in their respective budgets. And then they made these presentations to the Board of Selectmen in the month of October. Just wanted to let you know, and those are all on PEG on demand, and they're in the minutes. Here's what we did as well. We reviewed the CIP recommendations, which were accepted by the planning board, and CIP is a planning tool. It's not really a budget tool, so they look at all of our capital needs. They try to span them out over the course of years so that we don't get, you know, jammed up in 1 or 2 years where we have all these things that have to get replaced or fixed, et cetera. So the planning board does that. Then it becomes, it goes to the Board of Selectmen and to you, the Budget Committee, to determine, can we afford these things that have been slotted in certain years? The Board of Selectmen made the following cuts from CIP prior to operational budget reviews, and I believe this year we did that first. Last year we didn't do CIP until after, but this year we did CIP first. First thing that we did was we reduced the DPW road plan by $1 million. Now, that was from the budgeted amount, okay? It is a $400,000 reduction from the 2010 current level, all right? So so I think we're at like 1.5 million. We'll cover that. Carl and David will do that. The next thing that we did was we deferred, We deferred $400,000 accounting and financial software. Right now, our accounting and financial software is an antique, and it does need to get replaced. There's a lot of functionality that we do not have. It is very inefficient for us. We cannot run a lot of different reports, and quite honestly, how do I put it? In layman's terms, it would be like having like a 10 or 20-year-old version of Quicken or something like that. It's just a lot of different functionality out there, and it takes us a lot of manual hours to try to come up with the data that we need to make decisions, and that's not exactly a good thing, but it's also something that we felt was, even though it's a priority, there were a lot of other pressing priorities, so we deferred that. We also deferred $40,000 in land use software. In case you were not aware, the cemetery in West Lawn is almost at capacity. And there is an urgency to expand the cemetery. And what you'll see here is that we had about $158,000 was in the line to expand West Lawn Cemetery. After discussions with our DPW director, we decided I'm sorry, I apologize, of 148, and we reduced it by 138,500. Our DPW is going to use their crews and their equipment to expand, to do the phase one of the West Lawn Cemetery expansion, which I believe is down to like only double plots. I don't think they even have any single plots left. And I think now that there are people who know that is only a few plots are now buying them at a certain clip here. We also deferred a Wortherly Hill drainage project that was $400,000. So bottom line, and this is where a big, aside from operations, the CIP portion is rather significant. And you'll see that our CIP budget for 2011 is roughly $2.9 million. In the year, last year, it was almost $2.5 million, but I want to give you the caveat there that there were three pieces of equipment, which we'll discuss in a second, the garbage, the solid waste vehicle, the 10-wheel dump truck, and the fire truck, fire engine, that were all bonded, that failed a town meeting. Those were separate. And in 2009, our CIP budget was, again, $2.9 million. So it's kind of been somewhat level. As I said just a second ago, the CIP increase is due primarily to the need to replace three aging pieces of equipment. And I'm going to we'll talk about that later when DPW does their presentations. That need still exists. So even though we deferred it a year, we have put repairs into these three vehicles, and the department heads and the selectmen for each of those departments will go into that when they go over their budgets. The 2012 In future years, the point that I'm trying to make here is that when we keep deferring, we have a lot of other vehicles that are scheduled for replacement in 2012 and 2013. So as we keep deferring, we're getting more and more and more that needs to get fixed. And we don't want to be in a position where we were, I think it was in the early 90s, when we had to go and literally bond, I think it was like three or four dump trucks, five dump trucks. It just doesn't make sense. The whole purpose of capital improvements project is to spread it out, to minimize your having to bond or finance things, or try to keep it as stable as you can. Now, what else? So we adjusted CIP, and you'll see that reflected in your budget. So now I'm just going to kind of give you an overview for what you'll see throughout all of the budgets, regardless of the department. Health insurance increases were 6% and 7%. It was 6% for our non-bargaining unit members, employees, and 7% for our union employees. Okay, that was good news for us. We had budgeted 15%, and so that was a pleasant surprise for the board. We reviewed the various budget scenarios, and currently the board supports a level-funded budget from 2010. The Board of Selectmen worked with their department heads to make the needed cuts to achieve this goal. A couple of things that you'll see is that the wage lines reflect a freeze in COLA and steps with a proposed warrant article on the ballot. And one important thing is that you will see increases in the wage lines in all of these departments, even though I just made that statement that wage lines are frozen, because you have 6 months of wages that are still there. Okay, so because we start off, we give any increases on July 1, 2011, or every year on July 1, that's when they take effect. So you'll notice that even when you have a proposed warrant article for, say, a union, et cetera, the first year will always be about half as much as the subsequent years, because it's only 6 months. And what you'll also see is that each department, as we get started now, they will present their respective budgets. Some of them have a short number of PowerPoint slides. I know others have, it's longer because their departments are bigger. And then they'll be followed by a Q&A. So the only kind of ground rules that we have is that we're going to try our very, very best to stick to our schedule. And David Pierce said I couldn't get this done in 30 minutes, and I think I'm done.
Oh, wow.
Congratulations. Can I have a question before we get started? I'm processing the information in your slide. I assume these are available later, right?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So you asked department heads to prepare some scenarios. Are we gonna see those scenarios reflected in what we're going to see?
You're gonna see our proposed budget, which is a level funded budget. If you have questions about how, because we did go through those scenarios, whether it be police, fire, library, administration, what would it look like for a 10% cut? That's certainly part of the Q&A piece, and you can ask us, hey, what are some of the things that was presented that you did, that you didn't like? And we can certainly tell you those.
So all departments prepared a 10%
scenario? Scenario, correct. Every one of them.
It's not here, but they prepared it?
Yes, everyone. All right, now, our first up will be Parks and Recreation. All right, so who's gonna be doing this, Steve?
Yeah, I'm gonna work with Rick on it. Could you bring it up on the screen?
Here's your.
Good morning, everyone.
Yeah.
I don't know if, oh, I'm sorry. We all set, Christie?
Yes.
Oh, I wasn't trying to figure out, I don't know if there was something you had a question to where you all said, okay. All right, good morning, everyone. I don't know if everyone's met Rick. He's our new Parks and Rec Director, and we're actually very excited to have him here today. And we're gonna go forward with the Parks and Recreation's budget for this year. Honestly, I'm gonna simplify it real easy. We're gonna look at the total lines here, and you're just gonna see the comparisons from 2009, 2010, and you're gonna see on 2011, you'll see department head, board of selectmen, and what that change is. And you'll notice that historically, and the Parks and Rec budget has been low. And I think everyone knows that over the years. It's one of those budgets that comes in, everyone just rubber stamps and says, go ahead. So one might say, well, why are we at a 5% increase this year? And this is one of those budgets that when the board looked at it and when we looked in, and obviously we're gonna follow through with how the parks look, is that you'll see that our parks are in disrepair. In fact, a mainstay of it is our pools and the buildings that surround those pools. And the board, as well as the Parks and Rec Department, Commission, looked at it and said, we gotta look at how we're gonna protect those assets. In other words, it's one of these things that you just can't bypass on because it's gonna cost you more as you go down the road. The other thing that came up originally, you'll see the $62,000, which was in the department head for the CIP item. I don't know if anyone watched Monday's Board of Selectmen meeting, that essentially what we did this year was we are now not performing a sidewalk in Pinardville, and we're taking that money and we're gonna use that to repair the pools. And we're gonna show you some photos of the pool so you get a better understanding of it. So though our budget went up 5%, you'll see there is nothing in CIP. And, okay. And I said, don't touch that button, and that's exactly what I did. All right, let's see if I can go forward. I'm gonna pull my stick.
Just click the next button.
I can do this. I can't now. Give me 1 second, I'm sorry. One button I said don't touch. And I did it. And it was... Okay. Alrighty, sorry. Alright. Now the first slide I'm bringing up, and I'm not going to read through all the programs that we have in the Parks and Rec, but, and I'm going to steal a line I got from Rick. He says, we offer services from pampers to grampers. I like that. And I want people to understand that with Parks and Rec a little bit, is that they offer services for every age group, from, like you said, from pampers to grampers, and we offer services 12 months out of the year. And if you look at it, it's just interesting when you look at all the different things that they do. And it's one of the things I found interesting is when you look at how well it's rounded out, it's something that everyone uses. In fact, 2,200 people will use these programs during the course of the year. And now I'm going to compound it give you one other number. And when we do the pools, 150 people visit the pools each day during the summer for a tally of around 10,000 visits. So if you start looking at it, a lot of people utilize the service for the parks. And the other part that came up was, well, what exactly do we have for parks? And right now you'll see the list of all the different parks we have. Goffstown is one of those fortunate areas that if you look at what we have we have lakes, we have Glen Lake, we have the Maskey Lake, we have Mountain Pond, we have the mountain for hiking, we have kayaking. Then you look at all the different fields we have in the skateboard parks. It's a busy place. In fact, I'm gonna let Rick chime in on this a little bit. You know, when we say maintaining the parks, I mean, there's a lot more involved than just mowing the lawns, if you can just kind of chime in, Rick.
I mean, you've
some of you folks are all business owners, and you know that you have to maintain a lot of these assets to keep them up to speed. And just those fields alone, each one of those fields at Surrett has a full irrigation system on it. So there's a cost for flushing that, starting it up, and actually cost of water from Manchester Water Department for those fields. To keep those fields up to speed, you got to fertilize them, you got to seed them, you got to take care of them. They get a lot of use. You might have to cut out a section of grass, put in some sod. You have to maintain them. If we don't maintain them, then you see the results. So I think there's a lot to it. And as Steve said, all the time just mowing those fields, and they're used quite a bit by a lot of different people within this community.
And one of the interesting things, and when I was going through the budget with Rick, is that historically in the past, the budget wasn't probably as itemized as Rick. So you're going to see some differences within the lines. If I can tell a funny story, at one point earlier this year, there needs to be a porta potty at Glen Lake. And Rick, my understanding is that Sue called up Rick and said, hey, you got to get a porta john out to Glen Lake. And Rick's question was, well, what line does that come out of? There was no line. There was never anything in the budget for the porta john. So you're going to see some of the lines change a little bit from the prior year, because we're trying to be more of an itemized list so you can have a clearer understanding of where the money's going. Okay. And some of the other things that you'll see, and we'll talk a little bit further down, but I'm just going to cap on a little bit. They were talking about equipment, and I noticed that on one line, I said, well, what was the increase of that? And they were talking about a leaf blower for when they go out there. And I said, oh, the other one broke? He goes, no. He goes, what's the gentleman's name?
Mike Garrett, our groundskeeper, uses
his own personal
he's been doing for the past 2 years.
And what I'm trying to reflect on a little bit by saying that is that historically, we know this has been a very tight budget. And when we go forward and we look at the little things that we're looking to increase upon, to work on, it doesn't revitalize our parks to where we want to be. It's just a start. And we also, the commission also knows it's tough economic times, and we're looking forward to the summer to partner with volunteers and businesses to help and assist us in these processes. And so, there is a lot out there, and there's a lot to get done. I guess I'm going to...
Steve, can I just jump in? One thing that you will not see on here is that the Parks and Rec Department also takes care of the grounds for all the schools, which is not on here, which is huge in terms of acreage for high school, middle school.
We take care of all the lining, the mowing of all the, actually all town land, all the town lawns. We take care of all those properties.
Yes, sir.
So what does the school do with their tractor that they have at Mountain View in the high school? What is that?
We use that
for?
As well. They let us use that as well.
So you use their equipment, but it's your manpower doing it.
And when we say manpower, we mean the man. Okay, there is one man. And in fact, it's interesting because when we looked at this budget. In fact, a lot of times we talk about heavy equipment things. How can we extend it? One of the most used pieces of equipment they have is the lawnmower. In fact, instead of replacing it, we went forward with a transmission.
The walk behind.
Instead of, in other words, looking at these costs, because we feel it's so important to get the supplies we need to revitalize the parks. And when we say supplies, we're not, and Rick's going to get into doing Barn, and I'll do Roy. And I don't want to take too much thunder out of it, but I want you to understand that when he says, hey, we're going to replace the john, isn't that, we're talking the price of the john, the toilet. We're not talking about the labor. We're going to figure out between volunteers and Parks and Rec to do these pieces. When we talk about the sidings of these sheds, the pavilions and stuff, we're talking about the supplies. In other words, we're very conscious of how tight the economy is out there. But we're also understanding that if we don't go forward and revitalize these parks, it's going to cost more down the line. And obviously, we understand how that works. So I give that to Rick, and he's going to talk about Barnard.
I'd like to just say the same thing. Basically, we have some wonderful assets in this town. The two parks, 22 acres at one park, 12 acres at another park, and then you look at this acreage right here. We have a lot of wonderful natural resources within our community. We have a lot of people that like to use these facilities. And I think we cannot turn a blind eye on, we all own homes. We know we got to do minor upkeep here and there just to keep things up to speed. Compound that with a commercial type of industry where you have a volume of people using these areas.
we gotta keep that in mind. And I think when you look at what the commissioners and myself have put together for an original budget, it's a gross appropriated budget. You know, you laugh when you say porta potties, where's that come out of? You know, I mean, it's not in a budget. I have no idea. You look at office supplies, $150 is what is budgeted. We all have computers here. What's a cartridge? How many of those do you need in the course of a year, print cartridge? So going through it and looking at it, you know, it is, yes, it's an increase. And that is, it kind of is what it is. But I think the biggest thing to me, I'll show you some slides here. If we don't take care of this, you're not going to have it. It's just going to go away. And what are we doing for our community? We're not really helping those community people that need that help. We did a survey. We did a survey that in 2009, and those surveys came back from our residents saying, there was quotes in there saying, these bathrooms are disgusting. I don't want my kid to go use the bathroom. So these little things here and there. The other thing is why I got the podium, I guess. You know, I think looking at that budget that we developed, the department head's budget, we run a summer playground program. You got 80 kids at one park and you got 60 kids at another park. You have two staff people per 80 kids. What's that equate to? 1-to-40 ratio. A 1-to-40 ratio is what we have at this present time to supervise those children 8 hours a day. I'll move on to the next slide. Welcome to Barnard Park. First off, show of hands. How many people have been to Barnard Park this year? Excellent. How many people have been to Roy Park this year?
Come on, let's go. Roy Park, come on.
Okay, very good. I'm glad. How many people used the pool this year? Excellent. How many used the bathrooms this year? Thank you. Anyhow, I'm glad to see that. Glad to see a good turnout. Good amount of folks going there. So here we go. We talk about the pool. This is the Barnard pool. This was taken before we opened the pool, and what you see is it's a plaster pool on the bottom, and all the plaster is coming up. And how many of you guys swam this year there? You had a show of hands. Did you have a little plaster in your toes?
It's in rough shape.
Yeah, okay. What we would do is just take some cement, put that over year after year after year after year. It's gone beyond that point.
Is it gunite? What is it?
It's a gunite. It's a gunite pool. It's a concrete pool with plaster over the top is what it is.
Okay. Have you looked into fiberglass?
No, we really haven't. No.
All over California.
Yeah.
It's a permanent solution.
Well, I think, Guy, you bring up a great point, because I think the other thing here is these pools are 40 years old. They've treated us very well. I mean, they've been awesome. And that's a good question. You bring up a fiberglass pool. Do you put in a whole new pool? I mean,
I owned a business that called Aquaglass, the fiberglass pools all over California. I'd be happy to sit down with you.
Yeah.
Take a look at it, make some recommendations.
Because I got a quote for our Roy pool from a gentleman. They call it put a pool inside of a pool. And just to do that, that's $145,000. And they'll guarantee it. They will guarantee it, the outcome of it. But anyhow, that's the pool. The diving board, you can see how if you step on those stairs right there, they're actually going to break. It's been shut down. The State Department shut it down on us. Those are the lifeguard stands. You cannot use those. The plates are all rusted out. If you step on those will break as well. So we don't, for safety reasons, we use white, what do you call those, the $2 special chairs there, the plastic chairs, to guard in. You actually need a raised chair so that you can see and you have a better vision and all this stuff. So our filtration room down at Barnard, we have two, there's six pumps down there, six filters, excuse me, and two commercialized pumps. Dick Coughlin has been an awesome man, band-aiding these for the past 5-6 years. I don't think you can band-aid them anymore. They're at the point now where they're really starting to leak and they're hurting. This is a toilet that you will see in the pavilion out back. So our 80 campers a day, that's what they're using. They're sitting on that rig. Our Barnard track, I just wanted to show you this. What it is it's through, it's starting to move around, starting to shift, so you're getting cracks in it. You can see on the right, you fill it. Every single year, you fill it. Doesn't matter. Comes back. It keeps shifting.
Can I just jump in, if you don't mind, for a second?
Sure.
When he's showing you this, the pool part, honestly, we took the money from that sidewalk and then to CIP, and that's hopefully going to fund to do the repairs to the pools, okay? The second piece, when you see the increase in the budget, that's when we're starting to talk about the lifeguard stands, the buildings, et cetera. But we are not looking at this repairs to this in this budget.
Steve brings up a very good point.
We're trying to phase this out, is what I'm saying.
What if you look at these numbers, I mean, if you looked at what you
have. No, when I say phase out, meaning phase out the repairs. So in other words, we're showing you the conditions that, and we're saying if we don't start doing some of the things now, you're going to have a snowball effect. So we're showing you and saying that, you know, we have these issues here too, but this one won't be one of them. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Rick.
That's fine. Steve brings up a good point. When you look at some of the increases to these lines, like the pool operation line, the park operation line, you get a $8,000 increase, $12,000 increase. What it is a chipping at the stone. You know, we realize that economic times are not good. This isn't good either. So we got to have some kind of process to look at it and chip away at that stone to keep this operational, to keep it up to speed for what our community is looking for. The biggest chunk that you'll see an increase in that pool operation line is like $7,200, $7,700, and that's just the two filter pumps, the two commercialized filter pumps for that one pool. So that's over the lifeguard chairs. You know, it's like three grand right there. $3,500 right there just for those chairs. So that's, Steve brought up a very good point. And we're showing you this as in the big picture, we have to kind of look at it and, as I said, chip away at the stone and slowly bring this stuff up to speed. Doesn't have to happen all in 1 year. Absolutely, agree. But we gotta be sensitive to these assets. These are assets that this town has, and we should be darn proud that we have these facilities. This is our playground. You know, you go to some of the other towns, there's some really nice, elaborate playgrounds out there, too. This is our playground over here at Barnard.
That's your last slide.
Yeah. Oh.
That's right. That's fine.
Rest in peace.
And now we're going to Roy Park.
So that was Barnard Park, okay? Steve is going to talk about Roy Park.
Okay. And Roy Park, I think, probably has... it's probably the only park I know of that you come to it and you see a headstone. I mean, that's exactly what it is. We're wondering if there's someone underneath that stone, but essentially that's the beginning into Roy Park.
Mr. Roy.
But as Rick so definitely put it, we are just chipping away at the stone. I think everyone understands that at this point, that this is not a dream budget by any stretch of the imagination. And everyone's used to seeing this budget just being this flat budget going on, and what's happened is the maintenance and repairs hasn't been done, and it's catching up. And I did it again. Don't touch that button. What did I do the last time to get out of here? There we go. Thank you. All right. Of the two pools, the one that's in the most disrepair everyone knows is Roy Park. Okay. And part of that is that last year, Roy Park was losing 7,000 gallons of water a day. Am I correct with that 6,600 one?
6,600 gallons of water a day.
A day. Okay. Mind you, we buy city water when we fill this pool. To give you an idea of how fast that drain is, that pool, when the season ended and we stopped filling it, drained to nothing in 2 weeks.
A little over 2 weeks. Yeah. You losing it through the piping or through the pool?
The pool.
Let me ask you this question. If you shut the pumps off, totally off, 2 weeks later, it's bone dry.
Well, we've definitely gone below the skimmers. Okay.
We're not losing it through the
pipe. We're not losing it through the pipe.
And the pipes, I was sarcastic, I'm sorry. The pipes were redone in 2009.
Okay.
That's had a lot of.
So the pipes are in good shape.
Yeah, I mean, go ahead.
Yeah, the water bill, you know, the budget for water stays the same in this budget, yet if you repair the pools, it's gonna use a lot less water.
Last year's water budget wasn't based upon the idea that we would lose 7,000 gallons a day.
No, I understand what you're saying. I mean, that might be adjusted a little bit, but you gotta remember too, is we're watering and irrigating those Surrett fields. And that's a big portion of, that's actually a large portion of the bill too. That would go down a little bit. It would go down a little bit.
But it wasn't, what, last year's budget wasn't based on a premise that we would lose 7,000 gallons of water a day. Okay. All right, we won't, and I've been told by Mr. Gross to pick up the pace, so we won't go too far, but you can understand when we're talking about the structures here. The other thing is, I wanted to just talk a little bit about this pavilion, which is one of the other things we look at heavily, is that we have summer programs at both Barnard and Roy. And I think we said we have about 150, is that 150 a day?
Yep.
Going through that summer program. And I'm sure most of you already know that we are already talking about, I shouldn't say we are talking, we have a revolving account, and we're gonna go forward this next year, and there are gonna be fees for our programs in our parks. And part of that is to take that money, put to assist in the future development of capital improvements within the park and our programs, okay? And being that it's the first year going into it, we're not quite sure what that amount will be, but without the pools, you can't run those programs. In other words, no one's going to drop their kid off at a summer program at Roy Park, and you're going to, I think you're going to see the picture here. I'll just go here. That's what Roy Park is without the pool. We have a metal slide, a hanging ladder, and that swing set holds, I believe, 4 swings. The highlight of their day is going into that pool. And we think that hopefully, go ahead.
Do you charge to get into the pool?
No.
And we can't. Okay, because originally when those pools were built, federal money was used, so it's open to everyone. But once again, those people in the program, our day program, those are all Goffstown residents. Those are us, okay? And so without the pool, the programs don't exist. And we think that somewhere along the line of between the two parks, just in the day program, it could be anywhere from 40 to 50,000 that we could start getting in revenue, putting into that revolving account, and we can look how we can assist in those capital improvements and programs down the road. And so when we start looking and chipping away at some of these pieces, we realize that somewhere along the line we had to be creative, and the Parks and Rec Commission, I give them credit with that we had to sit down and say, hey, we got to be creative, we got to look at ways that we can create some revenue, we're going to have to look at our grants, and we're going to have to partner up with businesses and how we go forward to assist us in this. Sir.
Okay, I'm sorry, but you know for a fact that because of federal funding, that we can't charge for that pool. Because here's the thing. There's other communities around us that have used federal funding, and they're charging, okay? And that goes for Manchester, and that goes for Bedford, and I don't know what Bedford's mix of federal funds is, but they're charging, and of course, that's a brand new pool, so it's a
changes
nice.
Our liability.
The point is,
you're not a town resident.
Point is that this is a potential revenue source, and the federal funds are supposed, the federal obligation is supposed to end when the life of that funding ends. And so if it's 40 years old, I don't see where those numbers match.
That has been, I'll refer it to Sue because that's been my understanding. Is there anything that we should know?
Well, we just went through this with Glen Lake and they had no objection.
To?
Discharging.
I think you can charge these fees. So I think you can. I mean, people are doing it, as you just said. Other towns are absolutely doing it. You're right.
We're looking for other ways to lay revenue.
And it's a small charge, but it's still good to improvement.
But I think I have, if I have.
Hold on a second. I know we don't want to be here till 9 o'clock at night, and this is a great point. So I think if we could just keep going, because we'll be here kind of all day. It's a great point in terms of, you know, revenue and making sure that if something is federally funded, can we charge and can we get revenue? Because it has to do with the whole picture. But this is something that perhaps we can do at another time.
And Scott, if I could,
yep.
That's one of the things that we're gonna want to dive into in detail. So just for everyone to know, we were trying to do this to defer not bringing department heads back to the budget committee. That's not gonna happen. We're gonna have to probably get department heads back in to dig more into details, just so that we understand that. Okay, so what is your time?
Half an hour for this particular presentation.
Okay.
And we're at, we got four.
That would be helpful if we started with that, if you let us know how much time you're allotting to each piece.
We did, unfortunately, you hadn't arrived at that time.
No, I had to go back home to get my bifocals.
It's okay. Yeah, this one is, I'm trying to stick on the schedule for, in terms of times.
With that being, we're gonna have to close out because we have 4 minutes for it. But I hope you understand that when you look at this budget, it's just chipping away. Are we looking at other avenues? You're absolutely correct, and some of your, and that's something to bring forward. We'll take a look at that also.
It's just input, it's not criticism.
I didn't take it as such, so you know, I'm saying it's a good idea. My understanding was that there was different, but it's good input in. But these are the things that we are looking at. We're looking to be much more creative within the Parks and Rec. They're looking to revitalize these parks. And when I say revitalize, these are not dream parks by any stretch of the imagination. And we're looking to do it in a manner that's consistent with the economic times and what's transpiring. I'm gonna give you one last photo. That's what it looked like 30 or 40 years ago.
I found that. I think it was probably in the early 80s.
I mean, we're fortunate to have, you know, the parks and the pools that we have. And I think at this point, with 3 minutes left, I've been given the red light. I'm gonna pass it on. The clipper, thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick.
Thank you very much.
Scott, to Chairman Luthier's point, I know that we're going to have more information because I came here today prepared to see the 10% as one of the options. So the fact that it's not here is a bit of a disservice to where it is we were trying to go when we were looking at all options. So so I think it goes without saying that between now and when other presentations occur in the weeks ahead at committee, we're going to need to see the 10% option.
Well, I think that in this particular scenario, if you want to just go over, it was, from what we were presented, it would be shutting down Roy Park.
If I may?
Yeah.
The 10% reduction with Parks and Recreation basically is closing down Roy Pool. So you take away the lifeguard staff that are with that pool. You would then take the playground kids that would go to that park, move them over to Barnard Park. So you'd save another maybe $3,200, $3,800 in chemicals. Save a little bit of water. The other 10%, part of that is making a full-time staff person a part-time staff person, a 25-hour-a-week person. Bringing that down also brings down your payroll benefits.
That's based on maintain, and I know we don't want to.
And then that.
This is based on maintaining the current level of service.
Yes.
Because you said you service 2,200 people.
You're going to service them, but you're going to work your tail off to service them.
Yes.
I mean, I'm not going to take away those. I mean, I'll.
So I guess, and this is, and I'm fine with that answer now. I know we'll have a chance to do more Q&A in the next meeting. I would just say that, and this is just in general, Scott.
Yeah.
If everybody thinks that, like, even considering a 10% solution, and the choices scenario is, well, we'll have to give up X, Y, or Z to get to the 10% based on maintaining the current level of services. That's not what we're looking for. We're looking for people, the managers, to make true decisions on cutting back things to maintain the 10%. We don't want the choices that say we're going to make drastic changes just so we can maintain a current level of service. And so that's not what I'm looking for.
Yeah, we're going to.
Before you respond, you use the word we a lot.
Me.
Yes.
Me.
I got to make that clear that the committee has not made that decision on that. You're looking for that. There may be others on the committee, so that's important to tell.
It's not what I'm looking for.
Pardon my limping around here, because my leg is still recovering here. But we're gonna, the first budget that you heard was probably the only one in which, you know, we looked at it, and there was, as you can see from the photographs, this liability issues, which was not mentioned by Rick or Steve, that I know that the board is extremely concerned with in terms of lifeguarding, of those pools, people cutting their feet. Those are very, very significant. We must take them seriously. So this one, I think, as you can see, was an increase, whereas others you will see were for the most part level funded, and we'll go over how we arrived at some of that. I'm going to go over the town administration budget now. Just try to give you an overview of staffing in our assessing area. We have two people. Town clerk, we have three. Our administrator, in some towns they have managers, we have three folks there. Building and health, you'll see 0.5 and 0.5, it's one person. That person shares those responsibilities. Information technology, IT, we have two. Sewer administration assistant, and that gets reimbursed by the sewer commission, that's one. Planning, we have two. For zoning and economic development, that's a shared job. 0.5 each. Finance, 3. Tax collection, 1. Building maintenance, 0.5, for a total of 19 full-time, not including sewer, and 2 part-time. Now, here, the town of Bedford did a survey recently, and we were able to get a copy of their results. Let's try to give you some comparisons. If you'll keep in mind that it does not include IT and or welfare, Bedford has a population of 21,500. 18 employees, and as you can see, Merrimack 26,227, Laconia 17,000 people, 30 town hall employees, Hampton, and the list goes on and on. As you can see, we're pretty conservative in terms of the number of employees that we have at town hall providing services. What you'll also see from those other slides is that you see a lot of these 0.5s. You see 0.5s because we're trying to do exactly what you said, Bill, and that is have people share jobs, do multiple roles. This is a history of Goffstown. This is not something that all of a sudden we weren't doing. Over the years, we have taken measures to what good managers do, like you said, is to try to share as best you can and try to have multiple job responsibilities for one individual. Our 2009 admin budget was $2,128,885. And our actuals were $2,080,827. So admin in 2009 spent 98% of their budget. There was an increase of 4% in the 2010 budget. So now I'm going to go down to the last two. So now, Steve, which one was it? This thing? What is
The ones before
pointer.
On the back.
On the back.
This thing right here?
Yep, that's the laser. Yep.
Okay. So the department head came in with a 4.9% increase, and the Board of Selectmen is keeping it the same as 2010. And I'll explain to you the rationale there and what cuts are needed to achieve that. In the town clerk's office, there was a reduction of $2,600 roughly, and that was for printing and binding. That was for the preservation of vital records. Not that the vital records are not worth preserving, but we're going to defer that and try to get by. Finance, we've decreased $5,000 for an audit simply because we do not believe that we need to do this audit. We don't see much benefit in it. The school district is doing something similar.
OPEB.
You want to just explain what
post-employment benefits audit. We did one this year. But not.
It does not affect our bond rating, and it's just one of these things that has been done, but if there's no benefit to us, then why do we want to spend $5,000 on the town side and $5,000 on the school side if we don't need to do it? The next is the big area, and that is building inspection, and this is an elimination of a position. We've had somewhat of a decrease in building permits and some other things. But we're looking to try to, in order to make this level funded, we have to go down a position. Someone had said before, you just can't keep cutting supply lines. This is a slot that we cannot fill, and we're going to regroup, do some more cross training, and have those remaining individuals pick up that work.
Excuse me, Scott.
Yes.
Is that 44,000? Loaded number, or is that just the salary?
That would be corresponding.
It's FICA, Medicare, workers' comp, and wages.
That must have been a part-time.
Yes.
Yeah. Next is, I threw some other ones in here, in elections, we have fewer elections, that number's going down. Reval, I'm trying to remember what that one was. Same thing, human services, that's quote-unquote welfare, trying to make some adjustments to what our actuals were looking like. As I said when I started this off, the salary lines reflect one half a year of a 2% increase. So when you go through these budgets, you'll see that that's not level funded. Okay, so when you look at the salary and all those other lines below that, they reflect 6 months of a 2% increase. All right, and for those of you who weren't here, the town of Goffstown's year in terms of giving out raises starts on July 1. Benefit lines have increased, as I said before, to reflect a 6% increase in health insurance. We've included some minor adjustments for upcoming postage increases. You'll see an increase for renovations. And what we're trying to do is, with the fact that we're going to be losing a position here, we're going to be creating a revenue collection office whereby we will have four people with a supervisor in an open area where people can come to a window and multiple people can help them on a variety of different things. Again, to try to have more cross training. Yeah.
Will there be bulletproof glass with that?
I don't believe, we haven't looked into that.
It's costly, but
it's very expensive.
Department of Labor likes to see
they
that
like it,
in town halls
that's
now.
Not, it's a $17,000, John, that we have in there, and I do not believe it's going to do that.
Well, I just think
yeah.
it would take our quaint town away if we had bulletproof glass between
yeah.
me and Kathy.
Yeah.
yeah.
similar to what the Parks and Rec Department said, the $17,000 or a little bit more that we have allocated for that is really something that's more, you know, materials. We have Dave Roberge here, who is pretty handy. We're going to try to have him do the vast majority of the work. So we're just trying to do this kind of on the cheap, shall we say, but get it done so that it's efficient and it's effective for us. You'll see some increased costs for property insurance on buildings. And I'm going to assume that will be for police or any other department.
And
liability as well. We have some slight increases in our copiers that we lease, and a slight increase in IT computer software. Again, what are we doing to lower costs? Revenue collection will centralize our operation for greater efficiencies. Again, you know, being the position of reducing a position, we have to be more efficient. The revenue collection will allow us to do that. We are in the process of bundling our internet and telecommunications with a single vendor, and that's a pilot going on at Town Hall, and that has potential savings, and don't quote me on it, but Sue, is it around $4,000, $3,000 to $4,000 a year here?
$4,200 here.
Okay, I'm close. $4,200 here. If it works out well here, we'll incorporate that to the rest of our facilities. We're cross-training employees on various functions, and as I said to you before when I had that previous slide, I know I do it at work. It's really important when you have very few people that you're a jack-of-all-trades, shall we say, that you can do multiple things. And at Town Hall, they have been working to cross-train employees. The revenue collection piece will just make that that much better. So that when someone is out sick, others can step in very easily. If one particular area is busy, the other one can help, can help out. So what you'll typically see, say in the area of, say, tax collection, this time of year, tax collector will be busy. But in those times when it's not as busy, they can help out with the town clerk's office. We're also trying to maximize our offerings on our renovated website. It's these little things, again, that you try to be more efficient at. We have GIS and tax records and economic development information is on the website. Prior to that, people would come in and it would be a counter transaction. They want a copy of a tax card, someone have to go to a drawer or print it out. There would be a slight transactional cost, which typically wouldn't even cover that transaction. And then in terms of a GIS, we give them the basic information for free. If they want anything that is more detailed, they have to pay for it. But again, it lowers the transactions that occur at a counter. Again, trying to reduce the, you know, the staff count as best we can. So we're trying to use technology. And that is really, we have a, now is a good time, you know, for Q&A. So now you're going to want to know what are, right, Bill, you might want to know what are some of the things that we looked at? Is that safe to say?
Well, I mean, yes, but I know sometimes you probably don't believe the words that come out of my mouth, but I think that was a good job, Scott.
Well, thank you.
But I tell you, not that yours, Rick, wasn't good.
Thank you.
Well, I think, Bill, I think with,
I was feeling bad there for a minute.
The issue with Bill is that their needs were very unique.
Yeah.
And as you'll see, there's unique needs everywhere. But when you take a look at those lifeguard stands and the diving board and the pool, I mean, as Selectman Fournier said, we have huge liability concerns, and it just has to get done. So that's why when you look at your overview sheet, you'll see there's an increase there, but it's level in other areas.
It's hard to dispute that.
Yeah.
In fact, what I was going to say, I've used all the parks this year. I have a 4-year-old son, so I get to use all of them, including the pool, multiple times. I see it. And my wife works as a teacher in Bedford, so I see the difference between their parks and our parks. So I can't dispute what the pictures say because I go there all the time. So I'm not arguing the condition or any of that. I believe me, I'm not.
Yeah, I think we, again, we kind of saw a little bit of the writing on the wall a couple of years ago with, in particular, parks. And that's why the board created that revolving account, because it enables now fees to be collected to go into improving capital fees, because we knew that we can't keep going back to the taxpayers. It has to come from the users more, you know, more or less. And now this is, I call this one more of like the this is like the, as Steve said, this is like kind of the year where we don't know what revenues we might be getting in, but we've got to fix, you know, these primary type of things. So that, I think, is, are there any questions for administration, Dan?
I do. We've got Sue, Janet, and Kathy here. Do they have anything that they either wanted or doesn't want or want to tell us about something now? I know Kathy didn't talk to us last year, but she probably...
Yeah, we're good in terms of our schedule, so if there's... Kathy, if you want to start off, is there anything that you want to mention?
Heard the message that I think was born and brought up in this community, and I'm a taxpayer, and I'd like to be able to afford to live here in my old age after I retire. And so I look at every dollar that comes across my desk that needs to be spent, and I analyze, is this something that is a want? Is this a must-have? Does this have to be purchased? Do we have something that someone else is giving away that they'll give to us so that we don't have to make the purchase? And I look at it as if it was my own personal money. And so when I did my budget, I looked at what lines can use a reduction. I haven't been using all the money in supply lines because
I've
been
center.
Very conservative. I
in the center,
back
yeah.
A little bit. Any place I could cut back $50 or $25, it all adds up to a good bottom line. And so I feel that you know, it was a very bare bones budget. As far as working in cooperation with other departments in the building, I think that we have a wonderful team at Town Hall. Whenever someone is extremely busy, like right now, for example, we have people wanting absentee ballots for elections. We're up to over 250 absentee ballot requests that come in. It's very time consuming because it's not as simple as it used to be. The state has everything automated on a computer. So when someone comes in and makes a request, it's a matter of putting all their information into the system and generating labels and putting the ballot together. And then people need and are happy to get the individual attention at the counter to explain how to prepare their ballot properly so that it comes back and that it can be counted and it's not challenged by the moderator because they didn't fill up their affidavit envelope properly or they didn't seal it and it's a challenged ballot and their ballot's not counted. So, you know, we see people coming into about 75% of the residents come in to do their transactions in person in our office. And so as far as mail-in and automatic online registrations, we range anywhere from 21 to 25% on a monthly basis of those transactions. And we're going to be coming back to the selectmen when they have their annual review of fees. Because, for example, with E-Reg, our online registration for motor vehicles, that particular area, when people pay to go through a vendor and they pay 35 cents to log on and $1.50 per vehicle to do their transaction, that's not covering the cost of our department to send them back the registration. We're purchasing the envelope to mail it back. We're purchasing the stamp versus the people that are mailing in and providing us a self-addressed stamped envelope. We have to buy special micro ink. We provide the check stock to produce a check to the state and the town to pay for the transaction. We have to electronically balance that. And then, even though the person's not in front of us, we have to process all their motor vehicle registrations individually. So we're not saving time, manpower-wise, in our office to do those transactions. We're providing a service to the customers that they want to convenience. Make their own personal decision about how they manage their money, whether they want to do the transaction electronically or take the time to drive across town to do the transaction in person and save that processing rate. So we're going to be coming back to the selectmen next year when they have the annual review, and we're going to be proposing a $1 increase in online registration fees so that we can recoup the amount of money that we have to provide that convenience back to the community. We're looking at the possibility of, can we offer dog registration online to people that, again, want the convenience. But once again, in order to provide that service, we'll be going to a vendor, and there'll be a fee to the vendor per dog charge to register. And people will need to make a personal decision, are they willing to pay a vendor fee to pay a $2 dog registration if they're a senior citizen, or to pay $6.50 or $9 for a dog. So, my office, like many others, have many mandates from the state. The state is looking to cut their budget. We're seeing impacts in different areas from them coming back saying, you know, we want more from you, and no, we're not going to pay the fee for it. But you are required to do this according to the RSAs. So I can't say enough for the team, again, for the teamwork in the building. We have a great group that are willing to step in and look to cross-train where they can. We have some state limitations as far as who is able to do what, because the state requires a certain amount of training and there's security issues that we have to be concerned about to meet those requirements and to allow people to do different tasks. So, are there any questions? Thank you for an opportunity to address the board.
Thank you, Kathy. Sue, I think you wanted to throw in a few things as well.
I did. I just want you to know, to get to level funded here, we're very driven by labor, and so we had to cut one position, and that was in the land use office. And as Scott pointed out, the tasks will be redistributed. Now, we all know building permits are down, but I don't want you to think those people have been idle. They have been doing a lot of the back burner stuff that never got done, plus they're extremely busy taking applications for the Lynchville water sewer water hookup. So that's been keeping them quite busy. But when the economy turns around and building permits are up, we will need that position reinstated at that time. For now, we will disperse those jobs to others in town hall, but there was no other way to get to a level funded budget but to cut a person. Not something any of us like to do, but so we looked at where the workload was, and since the workload had decreased in that office, that's where we decided to go. I also want to recognize one reason, and Scott pointed this out, that the workload has dropped also is because of our use of technology on the website. Vision appraisal is now on the website, as well as GIS. That has meant that the foot traffic isn't as busy in that particular office, land use office. And I want to recognize and thank the Goffstown Industrial Corporation, who funded that this year to get that online. That was a donation from them, and it didn't cost us any money, but there are fees next year. And when Scott mentioned the increase in computer software, those are the license fees to keep those programs going online to reduce that foot traffic here. So I hope you'll support that. The other thing that even the selectmen didn't see in our budget that we cut before it even got to the selectmen was contracted services in the reval department. We had about 3 or 4 years ago developed a plan with the Department of Revenue Administration regarding our list and measure, and as all of you know, the list and measurers were out there for the past 5 years. This is supposed to be an ongoing annual event where you do 1/5 of the town each year. We'll do as much as our in-house assessor can do next year. We did not put in for contracted service next year, so we recognizing the economy. So we will be behind because he won't get done as much as if we had had that contracted service in there. So I just wanted to point that out. Thank you.
Are there any questions on the administration side? I'll just leave it, and I'll close in saying this, is that the technology piece that we've tried to accomplish with Vision and GIS and others means that we can do more with less bodies. And please, although we do not have a whole lot in there in this year's budget for that, in future year's budget, if we can use IT to help stave off the need to hire, or if we can decrease when someone, or through attrition, not have to hire someone, because it means that we have to buy a piece of software to accomplish that, I hope that you would support that. And you'll see that in many of the departments. I mean, Diane can brag on some of the things that she's doing later at the library that has really helped them keep their budget in check through the use of technology. We are a little ahead of schedule, and we didn't really build in break. So I think this would be a really good time for us to take a stretch, use the restrooms, which are down here. There is a water cooler as well. So if we could, can we get back here at 10:15? Is that good? To give everybody like 8 minutes or so?
Yeah.
All right. Thanks a lot. to get going again, I just want to let you know of a little bit of a change in schedule. I've asked Diane and the library trustees to come in a little early because I think we're about 30 to 45 minutes ahead. So the library will present to us before lunch, okay? That might be good, is that hopefully if things are trending the way they are, we might be done at like 3 o'clock. So we're just trying to... Okay, is everybody back?
Yes, they are.
Super. All right, we'll turn it over to Selectman Pierce and DPW Director Carl Quorum on DPW...
Department of Public Works. Carl Quorum's going to present you four or five view graphs on what do they do. I know there are some new members on the budget committee here. They may not know the full extent of everything that goes on with DPW operations. Carl?
Thank you.
Just a little bit about what we do. Public Works is a very broad department, but this is specifically in Goffstown. Obviously, all the roads and bridges and the transportation network, the drainage systems that service that transportation network. We also do in-house curbside trash collection, and we're also responsible for hauling the recycling and the refuse to the ultimate disposal facility. One of which our recycling gets hauled down to Charlestown, Mass, and our refuse gets hauled up to Biddeford, Maine, and we haul various of the boxes to Epping and Concord and other places. We operate the recycling center and transfer station. We have in-house engineering. We take care of, basically it's a subcontract relationship with the sewer commission. We take care of the sewer collection system. Invoice them any time that our staff and equipment spends on the sewer, and we get reimbursed for that. Actually, cemeteries is a very similar arrangement as well with cemetery trustees. We maintain the three town cemeteries. We take care of the whole town fleet, the fleet maintenance for the whole town fleet, and we take care of our own facilities maintenance, the grounds around the transfer station and the sewer pump stations. Facility as well as those cemeteries. So there is a lot of things that we do. Obviously the biggest...
I just want to make one point. Not every town does garbage pickup and plowing and stuff for the school. Goffstown does. So similar to Parks and Rec, town of Goffstown does all of the plowing and trash and recycling at all the schools.
Thank you. Just a little bit of the biggest thing, obviously, that we do, the biggest capital expense that we deal with is our infrastructure, particularly the road network. Just to give you an idea, we measure, every year we go out and we measure the condition of all of the pavement, and we actually measure that in square feet. We talk about lane miles a lot of times as well, but when we're dealing with estimating repairs, it's in a square foot basis. So since 2001, when the road plan started, we were maintaining 14.8 million square feet of pavement. Now we're up to 15.5 million square feet of pavement. It's approximately 135 centerline miles. So when we're dealing with things like plow routes, that's what we're dealing with is the centerline miles. And we've got our gravel roads down to about 3 miles. I break that out separately because they're a whole different kettle of fish to maintain. You can't put salt on a gravel road. You have dust control issues on gravel roads. They're a lot higher maintenance. So from our perspective, getting rid of gravel roads is a good thing, but the capital cost of putting the pavement is pretty costly. Just a little bit more about solid waste and recycling. We service over 5,200 stops a week. Recycling is actually higher than that because we actually go into private property like condos and stuff with some of our recycling. We do that on a 4-day week, Tuesday through Friday. If you do the math, the simple math, 5,200 stops divided by 4 days, you get some idea of what our collection drivers are picked up, by the way, by one man and one truck. So we've got one guy out driving, picking up recyclables, and one guy out driving, picking up the garbage coders.
And while you're on that point, so that's a thousand, over a thousand stops per day on a truck. And one of the interesting facts you briefed to us a few days, weeks back, was manufacturers recommended stops, or what other towns are doing for stops per day. Do you have those figures?
Yeah, they, you know, when a town, like when the city of Nashville designed their automated collection system, based on manufacturers' recommendations, they built their collection routes around 500 to 600 stops a day. A lot of towns, the city of Franklin just instituted automated collection. They're around 600 stops a day with their trucks. So just to put it all in perspective, how hard this equipment's working and how good these drivers are, we're picking up over 1,000 stops a day. The transfer station is open Tuesday through Saturday. The hours are 7:30 to 3. They actually have to get there at 7 to get things prepared before they can open to the public. And the same, they're there till 3:30. They have to do their accounting things and shut down all the equipment and shut down all the, you know, the bays, et cetera. So their hours are a little longer than what we're open to the public. Just a few of the things that the transfer station takes if you don't use it regularly. It's a very extensive, I didn't even know I did that. but waste oil, all automotive waste, electronics, obviously trash and recycling. You know, the whole idea of the transfer station, when it was originally conceived, it was primarily to service our business community. We do not provide any collection services for the business community in town. And also large bulky items, our trucks. If you can't fit it in the toter, we can't pick it up. So it was set up really to handle large bulky items, yard waste, and commercial wastes. But we also take all these additional recyclables and recycling items. Oops, I forgot about batteries. This is just our organizational chart as it sits today. We have 36 full-time folks. You see, basically the way it breaks out, I have two assistants, the town engineer and the assistant director. The assistant director is responsible for all of the operations day to day. So under the assistant director, we've got a highway superintendent, and that's, he really does a lot of the road work. When you see one of our road crews out working on a ditch line, the highway superintendent is kind of in charge of that. Obviously the cemetery foreman, our mechanic and fleet services are under the assistant director. And then the utility superintendent, who does double duty, he takes care of the transfer station, the solid waste and recycling collections, and he's also the sewer, primarily takes care of the sewer. What he really does is the vac truck, the sewer truck that goes around cleaning drainage and sewers. So I think with that, we'll turn it over back over to Dave, and he'll kind of get into the budget.
Red came up with kind of a too dark of a shade of purple for how I look at it on my monitor. Here you have a summary of the cost of operating the Department of Public Works, and their lines are in three different categories: cemetery expenses, operational expenses, and then the solid waste. The taking from the top, cemetery, $121,000. In this year's budget, 2010, to stay even with the services that he had, would want to do, Public Works wanted that to go up 5% or up to $127,000. When the selectmen got through looking at all the various line items there, it only went up 2%, so $123,900. I'll have a slide in a moment that shows what items we increased or decreased in each one of these categories to go from a department head budget to a selectman's budget. The operations budget was the one that increased the most, went up 7% from 2010, 3.5 to 3.6 million.
3.8. And when we eliminated some lines, and we also added some cost to some lines, effectively it ended up with 1% growth. And then in solid waste, Carl came in with a minus 2% budget, and we weren't happy there. We continued to nip away a little bit at it, and it went down to 5% at a little over $20,000 further out of each budget. We really haven't started to talk about some CIP items, but I'm going to add them in here. In our proposed budget, we have a 10-wheel dump truck, and we have a solid waste pickup truck, one of the two that run around the town every day. So a combined total for both of those trucks, $460,000. The West Lawn Cemetery, Scott explained that this morning. Were we to contract for the expansion of the West Lawn Cemetery, $148,000, by doing it in-house, we have some material cost in the road crews. Instead of working on a road, part of their effort next summer will be expanding that cemetery. The CIP item for road reclamation, there you see the $1 million cut that the selectmen took out of that. And that original proposal was true to the nature of the CIP activity, to maintain an even amount of road activity, road repair, road upgrade, year by year by year, so there's no big ballooning of costs in future years. So we are facing a deferred maintenance problem by that $1 million coming out. We did keep in $50,000 for Elm and Pleasant intersections with Mass Road. And unless Carl wants to correct me, I believe that's for engineering studies, not the actual work.
Is that for another roundabout?
We don't know. Engineering studies. So we don't want this to go on for
right,
a two-hour discussion, so
okay,
we'll
I
end it
curious.
There.
I was curious. I just wanted to clarify if someone didn't know where that was.
Elm Street, is it?
Now, I'm going to go into each one of those three categories to show you how changes were made. And basically, I'm not going to discuss anything with wages because they were just the same across the board for all the town departments. And some of that was explained earlier this morning. The department head did want to go increase the maintenance charges that vendors will come in and do certain work to the grounds of the cemeteries, increase that from $7,000 to $10,000, and that accomplishes fence repairs, repairs to some headstones, driveway, I think one further driveway upgrade in one of the cemeteries, and also install a well, which is at which
Shirley Hill.
Make the watering more efficient at that point. We did reduce $600 off that line and a minor point, but it'll impact some of the repairs that will be going on. I believe the well is still taking care of those.
I'm not sure if we'll have, if it stays at that level, yes.
Mm-hmm. He did keep flat lines for four sub-bullets, cost of water, renting equipment, maintenance supplies, and grounds maintenance, or equipment supplies, grounds maintenance supplies. And we did cut those from 12.8 to 11,300. And as I showed on the summary slide, he started out 5% over the 2010 budget. We finished at 2% over. Yes, Scott.
If I could just, before we conclude on cemetery, for those of you who don't know, we have a cemetery trustee board. They are independently elected, and they work with the Department of Public Works and Jason Georgiantis, who is the foreman for the cemetery. And I can tell you from speaking with Joan and Gene and others is that there are substantial needs at some of our cemeteries that we have been deferring. I mean, obviously, the West Lawn expansion is a huge item, but unlike some other communities where cemeteries may be managed from a paid government official in Goffstown, and there are other communities as well that have cemetery trustees, those individuals perform those functions, talk with people who may have lost a loved one, sell the plots, talk about, deal with perpetual care, all those different things that in Goffstown is done by our Board of Trustees, which are they're non-paid. And they do a heck of a job, and a lot of times this with no recognition. They do it because they, you know, out of the respect for all of the people who lose someone that they love. So I just want to make, to say thank you to them. And there are, if you've never, it's not something you'd say, have you ever been to one of our cemeteries? But our cemeteries are quite nice. They're very historic as well. A lot of repairs have been done to the headstones over the years, and, you know, and especially in Grassmere, Bill, I'm sure you've been to that one across from the Grassmere Town Hall. No, not, I'm just saying, you've probably seen it. It's pretty, it's nice. So just wanted to let everybody know that that's another way in which some people think that the town hall administers selling of all these. Yes, we do deal with some finance pieces, but a lot of the work is done by volunteers.
So, right on this one third of their operations, any questions about cemeteries? Solid waste. How did we get from a 2010? It evolved into a department head budget, and then I'll explain how it evolved into a selectman's budget. Benefits, once again, same as other departments. Public Works wanted to add funds to the following line, which was hazard waste removal, the tipping fees, and vehicle maintenance. We did not, out of those three whole categories, we did not support the change, and one bullet off. He wanted to add to those three lines, and we approved those additions, adding $14,000. Public Works wanted to cut funds from brush grinding, the road crew out on the that's not road crew, that's the brush that you have in your stockpile. Reduce slightly the amount we pay for a contract to grind brush, recycling, removal, bulk waste. So he cut those funds. We did not change that. We approved those cutting of funds and from 10 to his budget, saving $63,000. He wanted to add $6,000 for his fuel usage over the course of the year. We took just over $1,000 off that line. My rationale for that is that our trips to Charleston were four trips a week with a trailer, large truck. Now it's two trips.
The reason for that, by the way, is we put last year we had a compactor budgeted that was installed in the couple of buildings. So that's cutting down the trips we have to make for all the compactor buildings.
So a trailer going to Charlestown used to hold so many tons, and now we've doubled the capacity by compacting it into the trailer before it hits the road. He was flat on the following items, and we weren't satisfied there. We continued to make more cuts. Contracted services, essentially the bulk of that was at a contingency to maintain the cap that's on the former dump at Charette Park. So if there is a problem that would be detectable with that earth cap, we're sort of self-insured, but now I can put it back into correct shape. And a slight reduction on equipment repair line, $6,000 to $5,000. Good news there is, he was 2% under for solid waste, and we just took a little bit more off and made it 5% under. How did we evolve with the general operations, which is the bulk of his expense lines? We did not change a whole bunch of lines where he wanted, Carl wanted to add small amounts of money to each one of those lines. It, in total, added up to $24,000. There were uniforms, development. There's a traffic light repair at Pinard Square. The signal controller is very near its life expectancy, and it does need to be replaced. And that, so we wanted to keep that to occur. Slight charge, additional charges in survey, propane, diesel fuel, lubricants, maintenance of the buildings at the compound, signage, crack ceiling. I like, one of the things I like to talk about on signage is that we do have a federal requirement to replace all, practically all the signs in town, traffic signs, to a new federal standard. And this begins it a little bit. Public Works wanted to add funds compared to 2010 on the following lines. We made slight reductions in various of those five lines, and the overall effect was that they became flat with the 2010 budget. So we took line painting on the road. It's done every summer, spring. A couple, $2,000 off that. The reconditioning of some equipment went from 11 back up to $81,000, and we dropped it back to $41,000. We did that by eliminating the putting a new body on a truck, because that truck is in the CIP for purchase. If the truck were to be taken out of the CIP, we would have to then add $40,000 back into that reconditioning line to keep the truck drivable and useful for another year, 2 years. Even that would be, if we were to put a new body on the truck, even that would be a risky proposition due to the age of the equipment.
Are you going to be talking about that a little later with big items or no? Is this a good time to?
This is a good time.
Okay.
Expound on that one item.
Well, this last Monday, we did ask, you're going to mention it at the upcoming Board of Selectmen's meeting, but we might as well have everybody hear it. A resident called me and said, hey, you know, maybe you can fabricate, do some fabrication work, have somebody weld in repairs to the body. And unfortunately, we have already, Carl, if you want to expand on that, we've already done it, and it's already been multiple times.
You know, the challenge to this, to all of our bodies, we use year-round bodies, so the it's not just the standard dump body. The sander is built into the body, and there's a pumping floor, so a lot of pistons and a lot of movement in the body. And what's going on with this truck is it's rotted from underneath. And the whole rear corner of the body is just rotted away. There's nothing to support a repair to. You literally have to rebuild the entire frame under the body, which, you know, our mechanics, we have a guy in our mechanics that's probably the best fabricator there around. Keep the 10-wheeler operational, we would have to replace the body on that, or replace the truck. And, you know, the truck, just to kind of highlight the truck while we're talking about it, it has, you know, we track heavy equipment in hours, not miles, though it's got a lot of miles on it, but it's got 11,500 hours on it. And
made in 1999.
Yeah, and you need to understand with our dump trucks, too, this isn't like one of John Neville's dump trucks or any other contractor that's particularly, you know, mostly just hauling material. These trucks work hard all the time. They're in the elements. They're spraying salt. We discharge our salt under the front, you know, under the body. So all of that salt grind, I mean, is just spraying right up under the trucks. Think of what your cars at home look like after 10 years. Can you imagine if you're hauling around 30 tons of salt and spreading it right under yourself all the time? So the trucks really get rotted from the bottom up just because of the job they do. The plow frames and the plows take a lot of abuse. A lot of contractors won't even put plows in their trucks because it shortens the life of the vehicles. So even though if it was a standard dump truck, you might be able to get 15 or 20 years out of it. As a plow truck, you go over 10 years, you're really pushing your luck. The vehicles, all the wiring starts to rot. You start to get dry rot on all the hydraulic hoses. And that's where we're at with this truck. So even though mechanically we don't have any serious issue at the moment, with 11,500 hours, the mechanic told me it does leak, all the seals leak. So at some point, the motor would have to be done. The hydraulic hoses are leaking, there's a lot of dry rot. So at any time, you could have a failure of pretty large magnitude. And when you have a failure, like an engine failure in a truck like that, I mean, you're talking, you know, $25,000, $30,000 to replace one. So it's one of those things, you know, we buy the gear, but it's you're throwing a heck of a, you know, a gamble on a set of dice. So it's not something to really.
And I just want to sort of put some background on one of your numbers, Carl, 11,500 hours of usage on the truck. And if you want to do some mathematics on that, the typical work year when you're employed 8 hours a day, effectively is just a tad bit over 2,000 hours of work a year. So that's like 5.5, coming up 6 years of work if that truck was, you know, running 8 hours a day for six years.
What is the conversion of 1,100 hours to miles with a diesel? Is it automatic?
Well, you got a good point. Diesels are
is not a
better for age.
And you know, I can tell you how many miles are on it. It actually has 120,000 miles.
So you double that.
Yeah, 120,000 miles.
So it's 220,000.
And just to put it all, you know, last year, because the Warren article failed, this truck didn't get replaced, and the garbage truck didn't get replaced. And I had the mechanic run a report yesterday. Now, the truck that would go out of town, the trash truck, it's a backup truck. It's not out there every day. It's the one that we go get when something's wrong with one of the primary trucks, because believe me, you can't just not pick up the trash one day. You want a service that makes the phone ring off the hook. We're not there in front of the house at a certain time when people are used to seeing us. The phone rings off the hook. We've spent $27,000 so far this year keeping that backup truck functional. So deferring these kind of trucks, the longer we defer, and not having it, it just isn't an option. You know, it's a public health. You're talking about trash. It's a public health issue. You can't just not pick up. We had one week where I'll give Pernard Waste a plug. Pernard Waste is a Manchester trash company. When they have gone into automation, they have the contract to pick up the city of Manchester. When they went into automation, they came to us and asked our advice. We did some training with them for their drivers. We worked with them to help their drivers get up to speed. Bob Algar, when we had one day where the backup truck went down and one of our primary trucks went down, so we were stuck without a backup. We were on the verge of calling off our service for the day, which we have not done since 1995. We started automation. We have never called off a day of collection in all those years. But we almost had to call it. And we called Bob Algar, and he let us use one of his trucks for the day. And he didn't bill the town for that. It was kind of a thank you for the help we gave him when he was getting up and running. So, you know, it's a very serious part of our operation, and something we just have to do, and it's very, very big numbers when we don't do it right.
And our very observant, some of our very observant citizens in town still call DPW. Did you know Bernard Waste is picking up my recyclables? DPW wanted to add money, both the resurfacing roads and sidewalk repairs. After we got through with it at the selectman level, there it was lower than it was in 2010. So that's sort of compatible with what we did with money in the road plan. Took a considerable portion away. He did reduce lines. Carl did reduce lines in several categories, and we did not change those reductions with regards tree cutting, guardrail repair. The cost of water, miscellaneous tools, purchase, insurance line, building maintenance supplies, and calcium chloride, which I believe is for dust control. And my last slide, which is, well, excuse me, does a continuation of the operations. Public Works cut funds from these lines. We made further reductions. The salt line, lower than he had anticipated. That means that during the winter, his operations managers are going to very closely monitor the deployment of those salt trucks, and hopefully, and also reduce additional coverages. So if some of you may have seen a truck going down a road three times after a storm, maybe it'd be two times.
Are we contracted to pay less for salt this year than last year?
Yeah, that the reduction I made was we had a good bid price.
Good. All right, that makes more sense.
Patching of roads went down slightly. Contracted services, about two-thirds less, which deals with a copier maintenance that's no longer needed, reducing the contracting for video inside pipelines, and a slight reduction on disposal of hazardous waste. He did keep some lines further flat, but we made cuts, and this was the heavy equipment rental. Was $15,000, now $1,500. And the impact there is that if Carl has effectively two road crews out during the summer, they use a variety of equipment, and I would imagine in certain circumstances there'd be occasions where you would want to rent a piece of equipment to keep both crews effectively engaged. And so we're taking away that ability, and it means that the crews might have to work a little bit longer on whatever projects they're engaged in order to get them accomplished.
If I could just take a minute and chime in, I didn't completely answer Guy's question correctly. That I want to highlight that reduction I made in salt down to 204, that was two things. We had a good bid price, but more importantly than that, those of you that have been on the committee for a while know we use a five-year average to come up with our tonnage that we budget for. The salt we use annually. Last year was a pretty light year, so that brought the average tonnage down, and we had a good bid price. And I also want to just kind of throw it out there, when the selectmen cut it down to 189, I'm kind of okay with that, because the assistant director and all the drivers have been working really hard over the last, it's really two or three years, but last year we really pulled it together. We manage our salt use very, very tightly, to the point where DES has actually had us come out and do some talks. I'm sure you've read about the I-93 corridor widening. The big issue over there is fluoride contamination. I had to go down to Derry, they asked me to go down to Derry. They have a salt reduction group that's been put together for all those communities, and they asked me to come down and talk about our program. We're utilizing the scale house we have at the transfer station. Every load in and out of our transfer station is carefully tracked, how many miles the driver's covering, how much salt is being put out on each route. All of our trucks now have ground speed spreader control, so we're able to dial it down and really manage how much we're putting out per lane mile. And we're seeing reductions year after year as the drivers learn to utilize those reports and those tools. We're seeing them slowly backing down how much they're putting out. Our goal is always to deliver the service to the community that they expect. And Goffstown's got a good reputation for our snow removal, so we don't want to go so far down that suddenly we've got slippery roads all over the place, but we're really trying to scale it down so that we're optimizing what we're getting out of, what we're putting on the road.
All right, we got 25 minutes for Q&A, and typically DPW is one of our biggest departments. So I saw some faces when that organizational chart went up. Do you need any explanation? We're going to give you a copy of these PowerPoints.
We are going to
Yeah, do you want to go and, do you want to, you, I saw some people like, you know, looking at, but it went, we went kind of quick. And I think, you know, I think that's something where when you look at what gets done by the department, who's doing it, can you do it with less people, et cetera, those are the types of conversations that are good to have, you know, in this setting. And I can tell you that as someone who didn't know much about this department 3 or 4 years ago, you know, I am amazed at how much regulation that we have to deal with at the state and federal level, especially with the Department of Environmental Services, stormwater protection, you know, drainage issues. The town, and I know, just to try to share with you some things, we get letters, we sometimes get lawsuits with you know, structures that are, that somebody might alter or that the town may be liable for or not liable for, and we have to investigate those things. And many times that requires not just a layperson to go out there, but we have to have an engineer go out and say, okay, you know, are we at fault here, or is it some a private property owner? So we see a ton of that. A lot of the plans now that are coming before the community are these green drainage or stormwater retention type plans where you have detention ponds. Well, those detention ponds have to be cleaned. All the structures that we have, drainage structures, have to be cleaned because they accumulate, you know, leaves and sand and all other gunk that could block them. And there are, so when you see, you know, we literally have a crew that works on that, I call it the giant vacuum cleaner truck. And they spend, that's all they do, is they go around to catch basins and they clean stuff out on a daily basis. Goffstown, unfortunately, where, as you can see from the map over there, very hilly and a lot of streams and water everywhere. And when we get these 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 inch rainfalls, things end up where they shouldn't end up. We've seen that really bad during the Mother's Day floods and the one after that. So that's kind of what, you know, the department, you know, is doing. And obviously with curbside garbage and recycling pickup.
Does anybody want me to go through that in detail?
No, it's just that we can see it. I think that's why we all make faces.
Well, I just, because I'd be happy.
A little detail would be great.
Well, sure. Let's just take a minute, because I do think it's important. Everything under the town engineer over to the left, primarily, we do all our own in-house plans. We occasionally have to hire a consultant, like we're not traffic engineers. So when you see something like a roundabout plan, we don't dream that stuff up like that. We would hire an engineer to look at the best solution. I'm happy to implement them anytime I can because I hate traffic signals and I love roundabouts. So, but we don't actually do that.
Can you say a word about the roundabout? Do you mind?
No, I'm happy to.
Just really briefly, I'm happy with it actually. Can you say how it is cost effective over a traffic light?
Well, they
just the maintenance alone, is that what it is adding up?
Well, the maintenance, but that's not the big ticket. It is very costly. Like let's talk about Wallace just for a second.
Sure.
If we had to do a traffic signal, we ended up having to do 3 lane takings to do the roundabout, just the 3 corner properties. To do the deceleration, the extra lanes that would have been required to signalize that intersection, we would have affected 7 properties. We would have had 7 lane takings. We would have had to pay 7
return lanes.
So that in itself would have been much more costly. You have the operating costs, obviously. The initial upfront construction costs are higher because you're putting hardware in, mast arms, loops. Those systems always break down. So you've got ongoing maintenance. So there's all those costs. And then just for the public itself, it's slow going through a roundabout. They're designed to go pretty slow. But everybody kind of slowly moves through. They're safe. And most times of the day, with the exception of a couple of hours of rush hour, when things really slow down, you ride up to them, you go around them, you're on your way. And you're not stopping and sitting for 2 minutes waiting for a light to change. So, I mean, I'm sold anywhere they can go in, and I'm not the only one. State of New York, a lot of states across the country, that is, you've got to prove a roundabout won't work before you can even look and put a signal. So it's coming. Goffstown can drag its feet if we want, but it's coming.
If I could also, there's been a lot of philosophical discussions over the past where, you know, can DPW reconstruct our roads or build things cheaper than a private contractor? And we could spend days talking about that. I think what this board is trying to figure out is that, what's that sweet spot? Because we know that our DPW department can do the job. But do we have the all the equipment and the scale, the number of people to pull it off and do it in one construction season? So we've been having discussions with DPW about, you know, a very large project that might include, you know, 2 or 3 miles. Is that something that we could pull off, say, versus a cemetery expansion versus a small road here and there? And while I can't get into a whole lot of details about the current construction project at Wallace and Mast, are we having challenges? Yes. We continue to have some challenges. Our board will talk about more of that Monday. Some of that will have to be non-public. But regardless of whether we do a project or somebody else's, there are some challenges along the way. I'm not going to lie to you and say that we're not having issues and challenges with this particular project, because we are. We'll get it done eventually. But, you know, Carl is managing the project, and we're working on it. It's difficult at best. So one of the pros when you do it internally is that we can kind of go to Carl, what's going on, and everyone can kind of, you know, pin the tail on the donkey if you really want to, but because he's in the room or something. But it's hard when it's another, when it's an outside entity, and then it becomes a situation where you have to kind of do
subcontractors,
legal things sometimes. We'll have more information in the next week or two regarding that, but the board will have discussions on Monday night, and part of that will be non-public because it'll involve a legal issue. So
just to highlight, I don't know how much you folks get around town, but this was the first year since Mother's Day of 2006 when we haven't had a major disaster in front of us at the start of our construction year.
I had to say that.
Sorry, Chief. but we came in here with our every April, we come in with our plan. This is what we want to get done this year. And I remember this board, you know, I came in with a list this year, and they said, wow, this is a pretty
light.
No, they were
aggressive.
Yeah, this is a pretty aggressive list. And over the course of the year, one of the things with DPW doing road repair is we know we don't want to have to keep going back and fixing it over and over and over. You get a contractor in, the contractor wants to get in and out and save as much money as he can in the process. In our case, we don't want to have to keep coming back and doing it and doing it and doing it. So we had a lot of, because of cutting budgets, we've had to make a lot of tough decisions. Shim and overlay instead of reclamation.
Yeah, I
overlay
think
roads
like Tibbetts Hill, where some of us live close by, that was a prime example where we picked a section. We reclaimed that section and we overlaid, you know, the rest of it, and that was all done by in-house folks.
And what happens is, with, you know, the crew gets out there and they start looking at drainage structures, and, you know, Mike Hillhouse will come back to me and say, look, we're going to put $90,000 into this road to shim and overlay it. For $110,000, we could reclaim it and come up with a road that might give us another 10 years or something after we're done. This year, unplanned, I mean, we did that section of Tibbetts.
Lauren.
We did Lauren. We ended up doing Meadow, Moses, Miles, Mountain View, and we're just getting ready to tear into a section of Leech Hill.
Right, and every
so almost, all reclaims.
Right. And every one of them has been like a very much like a hybrid,
yeah,
where in the past we would say, okay, we're going to reclaim, and that reclaiming is the most expensive, and now what Carl is doing is to stretch the dollars. He's, okay, we're going to reclaim like the really, really bad parts, put in some drainage, but then, right, so... It is not the perfect scenario, but it's pretty darn good. And I think it's stretching our dollars a little bit more. And I know Nick brought up the issue with Moset, and we were able to pull that one off. So I think collectively the board is trying to, we're working with Carl to try to stretch the dollars out, you know, as best we can. Any other questions? Christy, you want to?
So can we see what a 10% reduction would do to DPW?
You can certainly ask, yeah.
You want me to?
Well, I'll lead it off, and then you can add details. I believe the biggest impact that was presented to the selectmen was eliminating 2 truck drivers.
We had two laborers positions.
Yeah, two laborers.
So 2.5
And then
positions.
A mechanics position would be re-designated to be labor. So we would reduce the staff that's repairing our vehicles, and some risk of a problem in that area, repairing vehicles. But effectively, it would be
labor that's available for the road crew.
Could you go back to the open fork, the fork truck you had up? Carl, I mentioned this to Dan, I think, I don't know if he's contacted the governing bodies about it yet, but what we're really going to need is a breakdown. See under highway?
Yeah.
We've got, I think that's three.
Yeah.
Operators and then, not what, nine? I think we'd like to see a breakdown, I don't need names, but job description or job title of all nine with exactly what they're costing us from salary down to employee development, unemployment, taxes, insurance benefits, the whole debt. So we can get a more.
Dan, you're working on it.
Okay.
It's in your box.
It's in your box.
Oh.
And just to, that's why I wanted to quickly go through that org chart too. You know, if you go over on the utility superintendent, that's all pretty cut and dry. That's the scale house operator. Your three truck drivers are the two curbside drivers and the one guy hauling to Charlestown or Maine or wherever. The solid waste operator is the other guy at the transfer station, the guy that's in the machine that crushes all the boxes, keeps his eye on what's going on. And there's two at the bottom, the truck driver and laborer, that's the backhoe crew. Those are the guys that are out in that sewer sucker. They're out day in and day out. If it's not too cold to freeze the water in the truck, we're out operating that truck. That truck has to do all of our drainage annually.
Storm drains.
Yeah, storm drains. And we do a third of the sewer system annually. So every 3 years, we're getting through the entire sewer system. The mechanic foreman, again, he's got a part-time data entry clerk, really, part-time secretary. And then he's got two mechanic helpers, basically. And those guys, one of them is an incredible fabricator. We do all our own fabrication in there, anything that we can repair on the equipment, we're doing ourselves. And I'll tell you, I can remember one time Heil Manufacturing called us and asked our mechanics how to fix one of their trucks because we had more experience dealing with it than they did.
Your foreman is simply not a supervisor. He is known to pick up a wrench.
Exactly. Yeah. He's very much a working foreman. And then the cemetery pretty much works with seasonal help, or the cemetery foreman is a one-man operation, except in the summer. You'll have two or three seasonal guys with them, depending on what mowing time it is. Now, under highway, obviously, that's where the bulk of the folks are. And if I could just break that down, in the wintertime, everybody on that chart, except for engineering and me and the secretary, is in a truck plowing. Okay, so pretty much everybody, well, the transfer station too, but everybody else is plowing, and there's a plow route assigned for everybody. So if you cut a body, you're also cutting a plow route, and we have to juggle and lengthen plow routes. We're already way over the maximum. We're at about three and a half hour plow routes now. So if you're getting an inch or two an hour, it's a 3.5 hour cycle time to get around most of the way.
And just for history's sake, I mean, you have put that in as a request for the last 2 years. It's been cut.
Yeah.
We've cut it.
Yeah, and this year I didn't even bother asking. But in summer operations, under highway superintendent, when you're in construction operation, you need a guy loading trucks. So one of those operators is in the pit, he's in our yard, whether he's loading pipe, loading gravel, sand, all the stuff needed to support construction operations. That piece of equipment doesn't really leave the yard, it just does a whole bunch of stuff around the yard. And then you break that down into a couple of crews. You have one operator in each crew. Depending on how far away from the supply we are, the production is all dictated by how many trucks. You know, those little six-wheelers, they're like feeding it with a teaspoon when you're trying to use heavy equipment. So we've only got two 10-wheelers, and when you get a whole bunch of six-wheelers, to keep the heavy equipment moving, which is what you need to do, you don't want the piece of heavy equipment sitting there idle because the truck's not there with material. So it takes all of those trucks to keep the heavy equipment moving. And then the laborers and the seasonal guys are pretty much traffic control. If you're doing a pipe job, you got a laborer in the hole, actually setting the pipe and doing the things that have to do. And what we try to do most of the time, like all the work we did this summer, we actually would rent an excavator and we had our own excavator. We operated two crews. And that's how we got all those roads done and all that work done. But we had to keep that equipment moving all the time. And that really, no extra. I know you drive by a construction crew, drive by Delorey, go down and see the construction crew in Pinardville, any construction crew in the world you want. You drive by, it looks like there's a bunch of guys standing around. They're waiting for trucks. They do their thing, and then it all depends what the flow of trucks is. You wanna keep everybody moving, you gotta throw more trucks at it. That's really the key to it all.
Yeah, we have more questions. We have another, at least another 10.
We didn't wanna go into 10% detail too much here this morning.
Yeah, I don't know what, Christie had a question and.
So, well.
It's a Q and A piece, so.
It's just a question. So the two laborers that you would eliminate would be the two, would be two full-time if you would go that route.
Yeah.
So.
There was no way to get down.
It would go from 36 full-timers down to 34.
We would move this guy, remove this guy, redefine his position, move it into here. So yes, we're losing two slots.
And the two part-timers and the six seasonal would stay the same?
Seasonal would still stay.
The part-timer that we had to cut was in solid waste. We have a part-time guy there now that needs a Saturday or Tuesday or something like that. We eliminated that position. We looked at, this is something you folks have talked about, a whole bunch of people talked about, but can we combine collection routes and get away with one of the trucks? And we looked at that and.
We looked at garbage pickup every other week.
Yeah, every other week, and it really, it's just not technically doable. The trucks don't have the cabana. We'd be making four or five trips back and forth to the transfer station. In my view, it becomes a public health issue. We wouldn't be able to keep up with the amount of trash on the weeks that we were dealing with trash.
And then you mentioned, you know, same side, we've talked about that as well. You're still making the same amount of stops. You might be able to cut the route. Then on top of that, though, I know this is gonna sound crazy, but we have a lot of residents who will call us. They'll call Town Hall and DPW because neighbors don't put their bins back, or they don't put them back in a spot where they like. So now everybody would have to put their, you'd have half the people putting their tote on someone, in front of someone else's property if they don't get home quickly enough, whatever. So there are issues there as well. Yes, it would decrease the, you know, the route to.
The usage of the trucks, just going down a road
one
time,
right? To a degree,
well,
but you're still stopping.
You still have to come back.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You still have to come back.
A lot of our streets are dead end, so
right.
You're going in and you're coming out.
It's not a one-to-one.
Yeah.
We did look at that. The other thing that I will say that folks can do is in the wintertime especially, like right now, if your garbage tote is not filled, if it's only a third and it doesn't smell, then don't bring it to the front. That will, you know, it's less stops, you know. Granted, the route driver still has to go and run the route, but maybe the route driver can maybe do it a little bit quicker, and it's less breaking all other stuff. So, you know, I know that I personally do that, and recycling for me, though, it's always filled, so I don't have a choice there. But the garbage, I can go 2 or 3 weeks in the winter, you know, not having to bring that thing out. It's usually one tall kitchen garbage bag a week, so. That's the little things that we as residents can take some ownership and maybe, you know, help out a little bit.
Well, in conclusion is that total department, we are officially $2,400 under $2,000 budget for the department. So we overachieved. If you want to give us back $2,400, we'll.
Couple other things we should brag about, though, I think, and that Carl has worked hard with the Solid Waste Commission. I know, Kathy, you were at a meeting recently. But this Concord Co-op, which the board just signed an agreement a month ago, is going to, once it's fully operational, right now we bring our materials down to Boston, and once we're able to, this thing goes up live, it's going to be in Concord. So it's going to significantly reduce the number of trips that we have to make and the duration of the trip. So it'll help on fuel. It'll help on hours that someone is gone. Because it's longer to go down to Charlestown than it is to go to Concord.
Yeah, but that's not going to affect next year.
No, it will not affect. Correct.
Gotta wait.
But when
the,
we talk
the
about.
The facility has to be built.
Right.
Yes, I realize that. So what I'm saying
right.
is next year, this
right.
budget we're talking
correct.
About is not going
right.
to have any.
But
the next year.
Right. Some of the things that, in terms of operational efficiencies, you know, that is certainly one, looking to see exactly how much salt we're using and trying to. So I just wanted to at least give you the impression that, you know, the department, all of our departments, and since we're talking about DPW in particular, we are looking at ways to be as efficient as we can. Clearly, you know, the people on that org chart, there is a crew that will build West Lawn Cemetery, the phase one portion of that, and we'll be able to do that at a better price than if it was done, you know, externally. there are certain things that this, that our DPW does extremely well, and these smaller to medium jobs, we do a very effective job with it. And I think solid waste in terms of recycling and all those other things, regionalization, we have an incredible network. You know, and I know that sometimes it is, let's pick on Carl Day, whatever, we all do it. Even selectmen call him up saying, Carl, what the heck's going on? But in fairness to Carl, he has tremendous relationships out there in the community. And when, you know, it's, do you think that it's any secret that because of his relationships, when our recycling truck went down, that he was able, a phone call, hey, I'll help you out. Because, you know, he's built those relationships. That's what good leaders do. And so I think we've kind of demonstrated, you know, here that there, we are trying to be as efficient as possible. If there are any other ideas out there, we'd be more than happy to hear them.
You know, one thing we didn't mention, and this is a small thing, dollars-wise, but it's a huge thing in the precedent it set. But we signed an intermunicipal agreement with the city of Manchester. They have a pilot program for single-stream recycling that they launched along the back of Elm Street. They're bringing in material twice a week. We get a Manchester solid waste truck delivering recyclables to our facility. We haul that for them and market it for them, you know, for lack of a better term, and we build a city. So it's a very small dollar amount, but we've set, you know, for years, the aldermen in Manchester, you know, I used to longingly look over there because they had everything you could ever desire right over there in that city yard, and you could never, you know, they just were not interested in talking to us. We broached that. The pervious pavement that we're putting in is part of the screen drainage. We need a vacuum sweeper to maintain that. The vendors that service, you know, you see sweeper trucks in town doing the road sweeping, those are not vacuum sweepers. You need a special kind of sweeper to clean that pervious pavement. We have a very small area. It's not really worth going out to bid for that. You're going to see a City of Manchester sweeper over here sweeping that pervious pavement. We have a road grader in the budget next year in CIP. I'm hoping to work out a deal that when we have a road that needs to be graded, you're going to see a City of Manchester grader over here grading gravel roads. So the whole regionalization concept that Scott's talking about, when it comes to pieces of equipment like that, the Southern New Hampshire Regional Planning Commission started a kind of an informal buying group or a purchasing group where Hooksett, Goffstown, Bedford, and Manchester are all sitting and we're talking about ways we can share resources. Work together to leverage our dollars. And I think we just have to see that paying off, paying dividends.
Yeah. I was just curious on the so-called green drainage.
Yes.
Do we have to do that by federal mandates?
I shouldn't say that. There are some new things coming out. Yeah.
Any new development that comes in has to eliminate low impact drainage before they could implement. So if you're proposing a new development, and there are a whole suite of potential low impact drainage systems that you can put in, you would have to prove that it's not technically feasible to use low impact drainage before DES would permit you to use conventional.
Well, what concerns me is these so-called green drainage, the time we send that huge truck burning fossil fuel oils over there, black smoke coming out of the back, and then spending the time for that man hours to clean it, which they are very high maintenance. You know, how green is the thing? And what concerns me is if we put in 20 of these, we're going to have to buy a new truck, and plus two new employees, and et cetera, et cetera.
The
long term is going to be huge.
Well, John, just to clarify, green drainage is probably a misnomer because you're right. The consideration is not the global impact of the long term. When we say green drainage, it's simply a water treatment. This is how we can get runoff treated most effectively before it hits the lake. It has nothing to do with it's the most easy to maintain, because you're right, the maintenance on these things is an absolute nightmare.
Which costs employees.
Yeah.
But you know, I think the public looks at it like, oh, we're green here.
Yeah.
And it's not green. We're causing a lot more damage if you want to look at the environment than the conventional ones.
Well, I don't want to say we are, because I haven't really studied it, but there are certainly other considerations that haven't been looked at.
I know we're pushing the time.
Yeah.
Just in they need to be done in the follow-up in the meeting during a regular meeting, it's fine. And so the cemetery expansion, we own the land, we're just expanding.
Correct.
And that was always planned?
Yes, it's been in CIP for a long time, and I think that it has certainly, the process has sped up simply because of the number of people are buying them and people are going in the ground. So we probably have, I'm thinking, maybe 2 to 3 years.
Well, they always projected 2 more years, yeah. Like you said, people start.
Now it's starting to expedite, yeah.
So and I heard you say that we as a town are able to do that more efficiently or more cheaply than outsourcing. We did receive a quote or two on it.
Yeah, we had estimates. We didn't go out the bid. This is simply a cash. When the selectmen, we're not saying that if you count our labor and our equipment and our materials and everything, we're going to do it for 10 grand. This is simply a cash in the checkbook transaction. And we have a lot of the materials we would need already in our pit. We are not going to pay for the road probably for the 10 grand more cover pavement. But a lot of that job is moving earth around, and we have the equipment that can do that. So it's a time issue. And we hire a contractor, and you gotta pay all of that. And we have all the guys on staff, so it's
well, I mean, that's ultimately the yin and yang of all this, is that towns all over the country thinking about outsource versus insource. So I know that's inevitably what everybody thinks about. So the cemetery fees pay for the plot.
Yeah, there's two fees. There's
right
fee,
to inter.
Which
you buying
the
plot?
Cost of the actual
right to inter.
Buying the right to inter.
And then there's the right to inter.
So you're buying the right to inter, right, Sue? You're not buying the land. That's
you buy
the
right to inter.
Right
they
to
changed
inter.
It.
Yeah.
It used to be a deed.
It used to be a deed, no longer.
But the fee is an interment fee. It does or doesn't include or allow, accounts for some kind of ongoing or some 5 or 10 year out cost.
Yeah, we can. We do have that. The cemetery trustees provided that information in terms of, in the long term, if you were to sell the right to inters, it would generate X amount of revenue over the course of, they said, 50 years, of which they believe. And it was obviously, I wouldn't say it's a money.
Oh,
what
is he talking about? Perpetual care funds?
No, not perpetual care. He's talking about the right to inter. And the cemetery trustees did provide us with a, I believe it was a spreadsheet that showed with X amount of purchases, then it would generate X amount of revenue over the years. We can get that to you.
Okay, and then the maintenance, and again, this gets back to the in versus outsource. So, cemetery maintenance, when was the last time we put that out for bid?
A couple of years ago, maybe 2 or 3 years ago, the trustees got some quotes. They decided it was better to keep it the way it is. So that's in the purview of what they would decide. And I think it was from Ian Kinesian, one of his last things when he was still on the board that he looked at.
Well, there's a few things there. So they decided to keep it in, but that was because the cost was less?
I honestly wasn't.
Yeah, we don't, that's something that the trustees manage. So we as the board.
Well, I know they manage it, but they're obviously obligating a town workforce based on their.
Right, and technically, just like some of the things that we do for the school, we as a town could say, you know what, we are no longer going to support, you know, cemetery operations. You're on your own. That is correct. However, I believe that there are, efficiencies in having that partnership there, because as you can see, you know, Jason gets charged some of his pay towards cemetery and others. It's not, right? He's not, I don't think his whole pay is.
No, he is.
He's
currently
entirely?
His whole
okay.
pay is in
okay.
there, even though he doesn't always
right.
go to cemetery.
Okay.
And then again, it's open-ended questions, and I don't really expect an immediate answer, but all the elements to run your department, whether it's the subcontracting of the cemetery maintenance, whether it's fleet maintenance, whether it's equipment and pup maintenance, and it sounds like you have some good people in-house, but the point is, we talk about, again, solid waste. How often are we putting these out to bid? That's really what I'm trying. In other words, a part of driving down costs, and you're obviously working pretty hard. I would acknowledge that. You're working pretty hard at trying to look at how we drive down costs. That's great, but part of that is in going all the way to first you have on staff, it's engineering. Is are we regularly, periodically putting things out for bid, which includes part of road plan, by the way. That should be just a regular thing. If we're gonna do this part here, fine, let's get three outside bids and let's make a decision that way to drive down. That's what I'm asking.
Well, just to answer your question, we do not do formal bids for a lot of operations, but I can tell you that we do track everything we do from a cost perspective, and I can compare that to bids that we do. We do occasionally look at outside services. Fred Plett and the Solid Waste Commission just did an exhaustive look at our solid waste collections to see if there are ways to improve that or do that more efficiently, and there absolutely are not.
But how do we really know that if we don't put it out there?
Well, I would be happy, I'll tell you, if I had the resources to spend the time to put all the RFPs together, I would love to put it out there. Because I know that.
And I know that takes.
We are as efficient as you can get. And as far as our road crew, which, solid waste, I can guarantee you there is nobody that's going to touch anything we do with solid waste. Cemeteries, nobody's going to touch that.
And my whole point is, in a down economy, when there's a business community who's obviously looking to hang on to what they have and they want to do more, whether it's legal service, engineering service, or the roads, or solid waste, or in the case like you were saying, that you've got two trucks running pretty darn hard, why wouldn't we try to consider outsourcing one of the routes? Or at least looking at ways where it's not a total outsource, but maybe it's part one way, part the other. Again, all the interest in continuing to drive down costs and fairly looking at an outside competitive way to do that.
Well, and let me, here's where I will differ from your own budget.
Just for a second, can we segue from the philosophy into the numbers for today, and then we can take that philosophy up at one of our budget committee meetings coming up next week?
And it was an open-ended question. I'm not expecting an answer today.
But
it takes a lot to put together an RFP. That's a lot of time to put together an RFP, but I guess to close, I maintain part of driving down costs and being as efficient as possible. That should be an ongoing part of how we look at all of this. That's all I'm saying.
And I do feel we do it. We don't go through the RFP exercise, but we regularly. I can tell you how much it's going to cost to put out the bid versus do it ourselves on every aspect of everything we do.
I know there's organizations, from a maintenance standpoint, private companies who would love an opportunity to bid on things.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it probably makes good business sense to give them a shot at it.
Well, we'll have a philosophical discussion. I've been in this business for a long time.
So. All right. Anything else pertaining to a budget question? Kathy, you were pretty patient here, so.
I just have a question. I always look, when we first get the budget, I always look over things, and one of the things that I just wanted to understand, maybe you made comment to it and I just didn't pick it up, but one of the lines in the budget for painting, and it says painting and REC, it went up drastically. It went to $81,000. So I just want to understand what exactly, where is that?
That was the truck body, which we reduced back to 41.
Okay.
And there's two transmission rebuilds in there for a dozer and grader.
But that's under painting and
reconditioning.
Oh, okay.
Painting and recon. And Christy, we'll give you the last one.
I just had a question about the signs. You said it's federally mandated if we start changing our signs.
Yeah, the reflective signs.
And
the reflective signs.
Retro reflective. Certain retro reflective requirements.
And do we have a time frame we have to do it in? Or?
We're already late.
Yeah,
we're already late.
So we
really?
Put that off a couple
Carol
of
Hill. Is it perfect to say Carol Hill sign is one of those signs, correct?
You'll see a few of them right now.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
All right, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna take a quick 5-minute bathroom break, and then we're gonna come in with the library trustees.
5 minutes.
I lost my chair.
Did I lose my chair?
fire department. Then from there, we'll segue into a sewer, which I don't think it'll take that long, probably 15 minutes.
Four slides, right?
Then we'll take a quick bathroom break, and then after that, we'll wrap up with the police department. All right? Then, if Dan and I could indulge you quickly after that one, just to try to, if there are any questions, we're just going to try to talk through the process and how we're going to make sure that we get you answers to the questions that you have. All right, so Chief, you're going to be up first. You and Selectman Campisano, thank you very much. Nick, anything, or you're good? I'll turn the lights down here.
Thank you.
All right, good afternoon.
Thank you.
It's tough to have the crowd after lunch, but hopefully stay with me here. I'll step back so you all can see. I'd like to do an overview of the department whenever I do a presentation like this, just to revisit what we have, yes, what we're doing, and how we're doing it. And most of you folks may be familiar, but for the folks that don't, they're not so familiar, we'll go through it. First of all, we operate from three stations, if you're not familiar. We have one here on Church Street, we have one in Pernardville, and one in the east side of town at the corner of Charles Hill Road and Blackbrook Road. When we talk about how we staff our department, we're called a combination department. What does that mean? That means that we have both full-time folks and we have paid on-call members ready to respond when needed. We operate using four engines. One of them right now is out of service due to a pump failure. With one tower ladder truck, one tanker, one forestry unit, one squad, we call a squad unit, which is a kind of an all-purpose type of vehicle. When we have larger incidents, it acts in a capacity for whatever is needed. If we need a supplemental pump to draft water out of, say, the river down here for a larger fire, be support at a structure fire. It carries breathing air so we can fill the breathing air bottles that are on our firefighters' backs. And it also has some rescue and extrication equipment that we may need at a larger hazardous materials incident. We do operate with two ambulances. They're fully functional ALS-type ambulances. We run anywhere from basic life support to advanced life support services using our paramedics. We have two utility 4x4 pickup trucks. This is used by one is used by fire inspector. Goes around does inspections with the unit, and the other one is used for general purposes to either tow our boats. We have two boats, or tow the utility trailer that we have also. Now we also have two SUVs that are four-wheel drive. One is I typically operate, and there's a duplicate type vehicle that is operated by the on-call officer. This is again a support vehicle for rapid response to an incident. We establish command, and whenever there's a larger scale incident, anywhere from greater than one alarm or fire, we make sure this unit is there to help coordinate the mutual aid departments that assist us. We have something new this year. We have one utility trailer that we use as a spill response unit. And actually, our neighbors next to us here in New Boston, they had a trailer that is in very good condition, and they're willing to donate it to the town, and we accepted it. And because we saw that there was a need in the event of a large-scale hazardous materials spill or fuel spill of the type, where, say, if we got into our water system, we could deploy some measures quickly so we could mitigate some of the spills. I mean, for example, down in the Gulf when we had the big spill, you showed the booms that were deployed around the well and so forth. We have similar devices now in this trailer that were typically dispersed amongst all of our other engines and other apparatus. Now it's centrally located on the spill response unit, and we've already had to use the unit once. We had actually a bus go into a swampy water area off of Shirley Hill Road. This unit is important to us looking down the road because now we have this new impervious pavement that's going in South Mast. The construction you're seeing by the new roundabout, and people say, well, that's great because the water kind of seeps immediately into the pavement and goes out to the drainage system, and it makes a way to Glen Lake. Now, I look at it and go, well, I envision a tanker truck getting an accident and leaking fuel and now having the express route into Glen Lake. So this is my help me respond immediately to a situation like that. Again, looking into our community and what our hazards might be. Hopefully this will work. There we go. We operate with the following personnel. Again, we have one full-time fire chief, one full-time deputy chief. We have one secretary, one full-time training captain, only one fire prevention officer does inspections. We have two full-time line lieutenants. We have 10 full-time firefighter EMT or EMT paramedics. As far as our call force, again, we talk ourselves as a combination. So it takes a lot of personnel to respond to our needs of our community and how we respond to them. So we have a combination of our call personnel where we have firefighter EMTs, just firefighters with no EMT training, or we just have EMTs with no firefighter training. Again, we try to get as much resources or any help that's locally and try to tap that resource so we can respond to emergencies as we need to. We have a call and part-time EMS folks that work nighttime to cover the first primary ambulance out. And with that, they could be anywhere from a firefighter EMT, just an EMT, or just strictly hired as an EMT or paramedic for that purpose. So in total, we have about 76. We have 76 folks on the books right now. In 2009, we had 83. So we've had a few folks retire. They've left the area, and we're constantly looking for new call personnel to help us because we are getting busier, and we'll talk about that in a minute. So our numbers will go up and down as over time, and we try to maintain anywhere from 75 to 85 personnel. That way, when the event occurs, we'd have enough. And just a quick note, at the time of the presentation today, all full-time positions are filled. When looking back on how busy we are and how we manage it with the resources we have on hand, it was interesting to look back on where we were and how we are today. For example, looking back in 1980, the department handled just over 500 calls, and at that time they had 10 full-time firefighters, including the fire chief and his staff. And about 10 years later, there was this significant growth in call volume, just over 1,000 calls, which probably prompted the need to add more full-time personnel. And at that time, the roles went up to 14, up from 10. We maintained 14. Full-time personnel up into 2008, where we received a federal grant under the Department of Homeland Security called SAFER. And we were able to get two full-time employees off of SAFER, and we're still receiving revenue from that program today. And that program actually, the grant itself for those two firefighters, the program expires in 2013. So we're still getting some revenue from that program. And you notice, just looking at projected 2010 numbers, that we're looking at our call volume to be over 2,300 calls this year. So as you see, the call volume has increased significantly, but our full-time force really hasn't increased as much as the call volume. So quick facts about our fire department and EMS functions. Since 2005, our fire and EMS budgets combined have increased only 20%. 20% since 2005. Fire and EMS calls for service have increased 29% over the same time period. Again, 2008, we were awarded two full-time firefighter positions under the SAFER grant. And again, we talked about the combination. Just to clarify a little bit how this works, when you talk about combination, well, this combination department's all over the nation, but they all function a little differently. For example, let's say look to our neighbors to the north in Bow. They're a combination department. They have full-time firefighter EMTs that work 24 hours, 7 days a week. Here, we have a combination department that actually works 7 days a week, but the full-time folks work from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. And after 6 p.m., the call firefighters kick in, and they know that they're going to be the first units, first personnel to get fire apparatus rolling in the town. From 6 p.m. to 6 a.m., we do have the two part-time EMS or EMT paramedics that roll with one of our ambulances. And that's 7 days a week also. So one of the measures we would look at how efficient we are in budgeting and controlling what we do and how we serve the community is the cost per capita, the cost per person in town. How much does it cost to provide fire and EMS? Now, when we looked at for Goffstown, our cost per capita in 2005 was $1.15 per person in town. Cost per capita in 2010 is $1.34. It's a 14% increase. Again, looking back to the top, our demands for services have increased 29%. Now, I said, well, how do we measure up with other communities that are in New Hampshire that are in similar situations? They're combination departments. They operate 24/7. I believe it's like McGrose. We looked at other communities that are similar to Goffstown in population, and I did the same thing looking at communities like Hooksett, Laconia, Exeter, and a few others that have similar call volume and population. And it was interesting to find the average cost per capita for fire services in those communities is $243 per person. And here we're at $1.34. Looking at just our calls year to date and how they break down, because it's always interesting to find out what are we doing every time we're called out and what do we have to deal on a day-to-day basis. Right now, 2010, about 49% of our calls are EMS-related, EMS rescue-related. 5% are actually fires, whether it could be a building fire, brush fire, car fire, you name it, chimney fire. We have our severe weather calls. False alarm calls is about 7%. Good intent calls, those are the ones that we get there. Somebody called and said, ah, boy, I smell smoke in my neighborhood. We get there, well, it's not really a problem. It could be just some smoke coming from a chimney, and we call it a good intent call. Service calls is another good chunk of our call volume. It could be just going out, checking a hazard. Turns out to be nothing, but it's one of those things we have to respond and investigate anyway. In hazardous conditions where there's no fires, this is where fuel leaks, our hazmat type calls will fall into this category, and it's only 7%. So you can see the lion's share of our calls are medical related, and that's not unusual for most communities and even states throughout the country. And I'll turn it over to Nick.
Chief, can I interject a question on the previous slide?
Sure.
So if 49% happen to be for rescue and emergency, who is responding to those? Is that the ambulance, the EMT paramedics, or do you have to send the truck to?
That's a good question, because we have a system now where we can now try to dictate our responses we throw on a call. With the state enhanced 911 system, we now have the ability with their triaging capabilities. If you call 911 because your family member is having a heart attack, they're going to ask you a series of questions that are pertaining to the situation that you have at your residence or wherever you are. And from there, they're able to, first of all, help you if you can provide care before we get there. And then secondly, they're going to triage that call for us. And there's about five levels of triage. And we could tell immediately that if this is a minor type of assistance call
or it could be life-threatening. Okay, for a typical chest pain call, it's they're going to give it a delta or echo determinant, which kind of gets you up in that scale. And they let our dispatchers know here in Goffstown what that triaging level is, and they let us know. So, for example, if it's somebody that just fell and just needs assistance getting up, yes, we're just going to send the ambulance to that call. If it's a heart attack, we're going to send an ambulance and assistance from with the fire truck. So we don't send a fire truck in every call, but it's all the ones that need that extra hands. And we've proven, and actually a national study came out and proved that what we've been practicing for several years is that we can provide better care, faster care, with, again, more hands providing that care.
What percentage of the calls do involve a fire truck as well?
I have to run those numbers for you. But
ballpark?
Ballpark, I'd say at least 50%.
At least 50.
If I could just add, that coding system that the state uses is based on historical data that was obtained from large metropolitan areas, and it's based on the number or the percentage of calls that end up ultimately in a life-threatening situation. So you may think a difficulty breathing is a call that just an ambulance should go on, but they may know that historically 58% of a difficulty breathing call ends up in a cardiac arrest. So the state's system may code that as a call that would require an ambulance and an engine. And if you think about the advances in CPR, at the paramedic level, you have an individual doing chest compressions, an individual doing ventilations. There's a cardiac monitor. There's drugs that are being given to the patient. There's only two people on the ambulance, and someone's got to drive to the hospital, so that leaves one individual. And that's many cases why that engine has to go. Provide that additional manpower.
So I guess based on the coding you're talking about, that big green part of the pie is broken down further by the coding.
Correct. It could be. And some people still call the 7-digit number that we have established back in the day before 911. And those calls don't get coded, and we kind of determine what kind of call it is. For example, if we get a call on the campus of St. Anselm's College, it goes through our direct line, and sometimes it does not get coded. So we have to use our past history and practice. For example, somebody called and said they've got severe bleeding. We may send an engine with it just to support it, and if they're not needed, they can be canceled and turned around. Another thing, too, to remember is the way we respond is we have an ambulance running out of Station 19 in Bernardville, and an ambulance running here out of here in the village right now. Now, we show that at least 30 to 40% of the time we call simultaneous calls. What does that mean? That means if we have a call here at say the Maple Ave School for an ambulance request, and then maybe 10 minutes later there's a call for a medical emergency at 50 North Mass. At the Villager. That means that the ambulance has to come from Bernardville to handle that call on 50 North Mass. There's a time period. It takes about 10 minutes or so for that ambulance to respond up here. We'll have an engine possibly respond from here on Church Street to help stabilize that patient until the ambulance shows up. So again, it's a tiered response to make sure that we get there as quick as possible, provide care, assess, and then transport.
Chief, why does an engine need to be sent when perhaps more health personnel are needed on the scene? What?
Again, that's another question that's asked everywhere, and for us, it's utilizing our resources the most efficient way. For example, we have a very large community to try to protect, and we're 36-37 square miles. So again, we have a limited number of full-time people or personnel that are available at any point in time. And that list of resources go down as calls start mounting up. Talking about, again, about simultaneous calls, it's not unusual that once we get to some one point that we're dispatched to respond to another point in town. So for example, if they just said, okay, we're gonna assist the ambulance at Medford Farms, at a residence there. And we're gonna say, we're gonna take the SUV over to that call. And as soon as they package the patient there, we get called for a chimney fire on East Dumbarton Road. So now they gotta come all the way back here, pick up the engine, and then respond to that call. So we're trying to be as efficient as we can, and yes, taking a very large truck to a medical emergency may seem overkill, but again, as soon as they can clear that call, they're now available to respond to that, and from wherever they are.
And how often does that happen?
Yeah, that's my question.
Again, it's, we're running about 30 to 40% simultaneous calls. We just mentioned, last night alone, between 8 p.m. and midnight, we had three simultaneous calls.
And just out of curiosity, I know Manchester gets paid, I believe it's $300,000 because they're private.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm not aware.
Have we ever looked at that?
We have explored, and Nikki mentioned more if you need to. We've explored the efficiency of privatizing the ambulance here in town, but it didn't seem cost effective when you're looking at the system and changing it and the provider coming in town. Without a doubt, it's my firm belief that Goffstown is best served by having a fire-based EMS system. And because there's a number of efficiencies built in with that, is just looking at the track record of fire-based EMS, over three-quarters of all EMS providers, not only in New Hampshire or nationwide, they're fire-based. And why is that? For efficiencies. You look at the people that typically respond to your community, are in your community, they're, again, the resources that are paid for this EMS service are there to support your own ambulance service. But it doesn't stop right there. It is, you have a standardized of care. You have a continuity of care between my providers and all the way to the hospital. For example, they always pick on Manchester because they're next door, is they have multiple providers providing EMS care. You have the fire department that responds, provides care at their level. And then you have your private provider come in and provide care at their level. They're both running under different policies and procedures within their own companies or departments. Where here, you're functioning under one. And then as far as efficiencies go, we have one medical direction that's out of CMC, versus if you have a provider, they get medical direction out of Nashua, or they get medical direction out of Concord. It gets very simplified. On your level of care that you provide. And when you invest in a system like we have here in Goffstown, that it just makes plain old sense that we continue with what we have. It brings in revenue to support the system. You don't have to pay for it in a sense. And we may not be in a situation like in Manchester that you could have a provider come in and say, we're gonna pay you to provide services. Only because they have the volume. They have the volume of calls to help with that. They're getting some money and revenue in from all the volume of calls that they handle. I think it's over 10,000 calls that they handle. Versus here, we do, say, just over 1,000 transports a year. The volume's not there, but the demand is there to have two ambulances. So when you look at a private provider, you say, how much would it cost the town of Goffstown to have you bring in two ambulances staffed 24/7 for the town of Goffstown. I've never heard from anybody saying that we're going to pay the town of Goffstown. It's going to be more like what happened in Milford. What happened in Milford years ago, they did the same thing, and it came a private provider said, well, not only do you have to give us all your ambulances and equipment that you've invested in over the years, but after a certain number of years, we're going to charge you about $500,000. Provide that same service. We're here, service sustains itself.
Yeah, but I just think, you know, right next to Manchester, we could have one ambulance and then have Manchester as a backup if we use the same company, because I look at the bottom line here, which I believe is $611,000 to run that.
That's right. That number is actually 421. What you see there reflects purchase of an ambulance. which is offset by the EMS revenue fund. So the dollar figure that you see there, that 600,000 figure, includes the ambulance purchase.
That's
the actual EMS budget is 421, which you'll see on the next slide.
And from what I understand is that Manchester, when they switched ambulance companies, really hired a lot of the same employees. So we would probably get some of the same behavior, I would assume. You know, it was just a thought why we are doing it.
Why would we periodically put out an RFI to compare services? I think it's, again, it's a philosophy issue, but it, and it's not something that's going to impact the
and
bottom
that,
line budget
I will be able to provide the budget committee with that information in the near future.
Well, the biggest thing that I'm after is Fred Pallett told me one time that the insurance pays for some of our calls. What I said to Fred is, I said, does it pay for the employees, the workers' comp, the huge retirement, et cetera, et cetera? You know, we have to look at all those costs.
But I believe the answer to the question is yes. It is self-funded.
For everything, right down to
the EMS budget is self-funded. So if you look at the revenue projections, it's to the dollar with the appropriation.
Right. Our EMS currently pays for itself,
including the ambulance.
But I think, though, if you go further and you look at that $421,000 that it costs us now, if we were to get an ambulance 24/7, that's 8 employees that the company would have to hire. We then lose our EMS revenue. Do we keep the ambulance in the village, or do we get rid of that? I mean, there's a lot of costs that are involved, and it's not as clear cut, but as I said, we will get you that information from some.
And what's interesting is, if you look, I always keep track of the progression of EMS in not only locally but nationally. And without a doubt, the trend is, surprisingly, in an economy that you were faced with, is even the larger cities have gone to taking over the ambulance service from private providers for a number of reasons, whether it's a standard of care issue or just the issue of providing the service. For example, Orlando, Florida, they took over their system. City of New York City took over their EMS system. And again, locally too, you're looking at in New Hampshire, some of the large cities, I won't name them, but they're looking at providing their own service, taking away from private providers. I'll give an example. What happened in Hampstead, New Hampshire, is they had EMR as their private contractor. Like any contract, they have the opportunity to get out within, say, 60 days. In that particular case, was a 60-day out clause. All right. EMR determined they weren't making the bottom line on that particular community. They called that community and said, "We're done in 60 days." They said they had a scramble looking for an EMS provider, and they actually had to use mutual aid. The Derry Fire Department to provide the ambulance service. And it's a scary thought, thinking that a community could be held hostage with a basic life support or advanced life support for your community. Okay, we'll wrap it up, but anyway, we'll talk about that later.
Can I ask a question? Excuse me. In regards to, I know last year we looked at increasing the fees to come closer to the national average. How did that work out for us this year? Did we see an increase, or?
What was interesting is we increased the rates to Medicare plus, I believe it was 20%, 20%. And so our fees, again, when we talk about what the money, the revenue that you get in from EML services, for EML services, it's a long process. You could do an EML call today, and you may not get all your money for that trip to the hospital until like 3 or 6 months later. So we won't see true effect for probably 6 months from now on that either.
Did anybody talk about it? I mean, do you see less people not paying?
I don't know if we've had many.
No, we haven't had any.
So that increase did go through.
That's great.
Yep.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. So this is a brief summary of where we are with the budget, and then I'll go into the individual lines. On the fire side, 2009 budget was $2.2. 2010 was 2.37. 2011 department head budget was 2.49. The budget that we agreed on was $2,384,811, which is an $8,000 increase over 2011. So it went from a 5% proposed increase to a 0.34% increase. On the EMS side, our EMS budget was $421,352, department head proposed, and it ended up as $421,352, same number. What we did, however, in the EMS budget, and I'll show you the lines, we made reductions in various appropriation lines that totaled $8,000. We increased, there is a line in the EMS budget that reimburses the general fund for the fire side for the EMS that's provided during the day, full-timers. That was $40,000. We increased that to $48,000. So the overall EMS budget remained the same. However, we made some reductions in lines and we increased the appropriations to the general fund. So that $8,000 increase in appropriations offsets the increase in the fire side, that $8,000. So the net result is a zero budget on the fire side.
So it's good to note real quick is not only does the system sustain itself, but it provides revenue to the general fund.
So on the fire budget, there were seven budget lines that showed an increase from 2010 to 2011. And this is operational. We're not talking about the that 2% increase on the salary side. Of those seven lines, heating oil, 50240, was an increase. Electricity, propane, diesel fuel, vehicle fuel, property insurance, and fire hydrants. Those were the seven lines that showed an increase. Of those seven lines, we reduced the heating oil and the propane, $2,850, a 12% reduction there, and $2,000 on the propane. And I believe these lines are reflect, those figures are reflected in the budget numbers that you have. All other operational lines within the budget were zero increase from 2010, and in many cases, a zero increase from 2009, or a reduction from 2009. So in overtime, we reduced that by $20,000 from 130 to 110. Clothing and uniforms, $2,500 reduction, 19%. Employee development, $1,000. Physical exams, $5,000. Training expenses, $4,500. Operating supplies, $2,000. Hose expenses, $5,000, a 59% reduction. SCBA equipment and repair, $2,500. Turnout clothing, $5,000. Furniture and fixtures, $2,700. So these lines were stagnant from 2010 and 2009, and we made these reductions in 2011. Heating oil, we reduced it, as I said, $2,850. There was an overall increase there. Propane, we reduced by $2,000. Opticom maintenance. Opticom is that sensor that you see over traffic lights when the fire apparatus is coming with their lights and sirens. It senses their strobe light, turns the lights green. This is a repair and maintenance line for that, which is reduced by $3,000. Alarm repairs and maintenance, $1,000 reduction. New radios. That was a 50% reduction, $5,000. Maintenance charges for vehicles, $9,439. Small equipment, $2,880. Station repairs, $5,000. Those reductions brought the budget to the 2010 levels. On the EMS side, there were two lines that showed increases from 2010 to 2011. Property insurance was one, and fuel was the other. There was a $2,400 increase in property insurance and a $128 increase in fuel. Yes, Guy.
Nick, could you go back to the previous slide for a minute? Okay, so the reduction we're looking at on the right column is not a reduction to the 2010 budget, but it's a reduction to the requested budget?
The requested budgets were the same. If you see in the change, other than heating oil and propane, as I said, there were seven lines that increased. Opticom maintenance, in 2009, it was 12,700. 2010, it was 5,500. 2011, it was requested to stay at 5,500. We reduced it by $3,000.
So they are reductions, though?
They're all reductions.
Okay. All right, thanks.
None of those lines, other than those seven increased lines, showed any increase from 2010 to 2011, but we still made reductions to them.
Okay. Actually, right. Mostly the lines that we're talking about here haven't been increased since 2005.
So there were two lines that increased in the EMS, property insurance and fuel. And again, there were three lines, physical exams, turnout clothing, and radios. That again, zero increases from 2010 to 2011, but there were $8,000 in reductions. And then in the reimbursement to the general fund, there was a corresponding $8,000 increase. So the net bottom line to the EMS budget remained the same from the department head request to the selectman's budget. And that is a $1,515 increase over last year's budget. But again, the EMS budget is self-funded through the EMS revenues.
Okay, so yes, the maintenance line item, that define what that's for?
Which one?
Well, a couple slides back, there was a line item for maintenance. Showed a reduction.
The vehicles?
Okay, so it was vehicles?
Correct. Yeah.
And it went down $9,000, so
correct.
This is the big elephant in the room that nobody's talked about. Where are the trucks and all the repair of the trucks that I've been hearing so much about?
Well, the assumption is there is a replacement in the CIP. So we make the replacement for a new vehicle, we reduce the maintenance on the other side. Okay. So if the vehicle goes away in CIP, we would then have to look at increasing the maintenance side.
Okay.
Jump right into CIP. Here it is.
Okay. I wonder where it was.
Save the best for last, I guess. Okay. In CIP, the plan is to replace two apparatus that we currently have with only one piece. Engine 5 is a 92 E1 pumper. And this is the one that is out of service, that has a cracked pump housing, and is currently out of service. We can't use it for firefighting at all. The next one was a 1989 tanker. It holds about 1,700 gallons. And I wish Christy was here. She had experienced the tanker live last week, where we were standing by it. I was showing her in the truck, and it was, in all sense, it was tickling water on her. But that was interesting. Both trucks are well beyond their age right now. And they're basically obsolete. Tanker 5 is still in service. We do use that. We do rely on that in areas that do not have hydrants in town. It's important for us to get that water to the scene. So for replacement, we're proposing $550,000 for a pumper tanker. A pumper tanker has both functions of both these trucks right now. They'll actually haul the extra water, and has a fire pump on it with the firefighting gear on board. And that is also keeping in tune with the fact that we'll be using the capital reserve fund for the purchasing new apparatus, and that's in tune of $143,000. Again, both trucks are obsolete. It's difficult for us to get parts for these trucks for that purpose. And looking at these trucks from all the vendors that looked at it on repairing them, they said, well, it's basically plain and simple that it's not in the best interest of the town or the fire department to try to fix these vehicles. The next item under EMS is the replacement of our Ambulance 1. It's a 2005 Road Rescue Type 3. And again, we were showing some body corrosion issues, suspension problems. The truck is basically overloaded for this particular chassis. It's overloaded with the equipment that we put on it, then you put in the patient in our crew, and it's overloaded. What happens is, like many vehicles that you overload, the front end gets wear and tear on a regular basis. Just like any other vehicle, we have to replace the brakes on a regular basis. In the front end takes a beating, and we have to get constant front end alignments for replacing the tires in the front end on a regular basis. We've got some electrical problems. It's got the old solid state system where if you have a bad ground occur somewhere in the vehicle, it wreaks havoc on the system inside. And drivetrain problems, we're now experiencing some issues with the transmission. The proposed is $190,000, not to exceed, I should say, $190,000 from our EMS Special Revenue Fund to replace the unit with a new similar unit to our EMS 2, which has a heavier chassis on it. So the ongoing maintenance cost to the vehicle is